Knoxville, Tennessee, as we get you set for an in-state rivalry on this Saturday night in the SEC. For Lane Kiffin and the Vols, recent off-the-field incidents and a loss to Ole Miss have overshadowed what has otherwise been viewed as a successful 0-9 campaign. Tonight, they'll try and shift their focus back to the field and send their quarterback, Jonathan Crompton, and his senior teammates out with a win in their final game at Neyland Stadium. The Vols will try and do so against Vanderbilt and freshman tailback Warren Norman, who's chasing SEC history. It's senior night in Knoxville with state bragging rights on the line. ESPNU College Football Primetime comes your way next. You're watching the SEC on ESPN. ESPNU College Football Primetime presented by Citi. The Vanderbilt Commodores have made the 180-mile trip to Neyland Stadium. Tonight, Vandy finishes off their regular season against the Tennessee Volunteer team, still with a lot to play for. So glad you could join us on a beautiful Saturday evening. My partner, Brock Heward, will join me in just a moment. I am Eric Collins. Well, it has been a very difficult last 2 weeks for head coach Lane Kiffin, probably the most difficult 2 weeks in his first year on the job here in Knoxville. It was just 9 days ago that three freshmen, all recruits brought in here by Lane Kiffin, were arrested and charged with attempted robbery at a Knoxville gas station. Two of those players, Newkeith Richardson and Mike Edwards, have since been dismissed from the team and the university. The other, Jansen Jackson, has been barred from team activities pending investigation. Now, most recently, redshirting freshman Nyshear Oliver was punished by the team after being issued a ticket for shoplifting. Now, that being said, Brock, thank you for joining me. We had a chance to talk to Coach Kiffin just yesterday. What was your takeaway after these events?
And Lane's message has been very consistent this season about treating these student athletes like professionals. But yesterday, we got the sense it was beyond that. There was real genuine sadness for 18-year-old kids who he had to dismiss, not just from this team, but from the university as well.
Now, that's enough for freshman mistakes. Now let's talk about seniors. It is senior day here at the old ballpark, and well, we've got some great seniors for Tennessee, one of them being their fifth-year quarterback, Jonathan Crompton.
And Jonathan's endured an awful lot in his tenure here, 4 coordinators in 5 years, and he's playing his best football over the last 6 weeks. 16 touchdowns, 2 interceptions. That tells you he's improved his decision-making, but you'll also see tonight he's playing faster, his techniques and fundamentals have improved. The only disappointing news for he and Lane is that his tenure and his career, unfortunately, is coming to a close awfully quick.
Well, Tennessee taking on a Vanderbilt team that has had a very disappointing campaign thus far, but one bright light the entire season has been the play of freshman tailback Warren Norman.
Anytime you have a chance to break a Herschel Walker record, you've accomplished an awful lot. And with 17 yards tonight, Warren has a chance to break Herschel's freshman all-purpose yardage record. The good news for Commodore fans, he's just a true freshman, and he'll have 3 more years to shine in Nashville.
Another full house here at Neyland Stadium, fourth largest venue in all of college football. Kicking it off will be Vanderbilt. Ryan Fowler gets us underway. Spinning short kick, fielded at the 9-yard line. Freshman David Oku has the football, and Oku gets out close to the 40-yard line. He crosses it, a return of 32 yards. And here is number 8, fifth-year senior quarterback Jonathan Crompton.
You know, those 4 systems we just talked about, he told us very explicitly that this system fits him the best. He really enjoys the way that Lane goes about the preparation. That professionalism that Lane talks about an awful lot has sure helped Jonathan evolve this year as a quarterback.
In the backfield behind him, fellow senior Montario Hardesty. And Crompton fakes the handoff, rollout. Pass complete in the flat. Luke Stocker, tight end, barrels out for a gain of 9 yards. Take a look at the impact players for the Vols.
Another senior, Montario Hardesty, also having the best year of his career, 4th in the SEC in yards rushing. On the other side, Rico McCoy, he plays that coveted weak side linebacker position, so popular in Monty Kiffin's system. Very productive linebacker, and Eric Berry, he's number 1 on some NFL draft boards, and he's just a true junior.
Quite possibly this is the final home game for Eric Berry. A lot of whispers that he may be leaving to go to the NFL after this season. Hardesty, his first carry, gets the first down and more. Rumbles out across the 50 and pick up the 5. Items floating by top of your screen. Tennessee so far this season, a 500 club, 5 wins, 5 losses. They still got another conference game 7 days from now against the Kentucky Wildcats. That game will be played in Lexington. Just getting started here in Knoxville, Tennessee. Third play from scrimmage. Compton under center. Hands it off to Hardesty. Off tackle. Not much doing there. Tackle made by the middle linebacker for Vanderbilt, Chris Marr, who has had a solid second season in Nashville.
Now he leads the SEC in total tackles, and you can see just from that play, he plays low to the ground. He's just over 6 foot tall. Excellent pad level. Helps him make many of those tackles, well over 100 already this season.
Another handoff. Hardesty breaks through the first wave, gets close to the first down marker. And we were talking about Chris Marr. He'll be playing without his running mate. Patrick Benoit, who suffered a concussion a week ago, will not be in his normal linebacking spot for Vanderbilt. And he joins a whole list of injured players. Myron Lewis, there he is with the baseball hat on. Myron Lewis, one of the best cornerbacks in all of college football. He hurt his knee a week ago, and he will not play today. Third down and 1. Harold Jones, the man in motion. They stay on the ground, and they get the first down and much more. Inside the 30, a pickup of 10 for Hardesty.
And Benoit's a big loss for Vanderbilt. He is a senior. He was second team all SEC last year. They've had to move pieces around, and you're going to see the challenge. John Stokes, the weak side linebacker, right there taking on the fullback. That's a play that Patrick Benoit made for many years here. Going to be a challenge for Stokes. He, too, has played some football. Lots of injuries have ravaged this Vanderbilt defense.
Final home game for Ontario Hardesty, who's over 2,000 career yards. Compton. Pass is complete down the sideline. Down to the 5-yard line goes the fullback, Kevin Cooper.
And if you've watched USC football over the years, whether it was Norm Chow initially, then Lane Kiffin, Steve Sarkisian, to follow, one thing popular in these systems is the use of the fullback out of the backfield, not just downhill on a linebacker blocking, as you saw in that 3rd and 1. Also the ability, and Kevin has it, to get in that flat and up the sidelines to make plays in the passing game as well.
12th catch of the season for Cooper. Knocking at the door. First drive of the ball game. Volunteers showing off that fancy offense. Hand off. Hardesty still turning. Touchdown! Touchdown of the season, Ontario Hardesty from 6 yards out.
Nothing real fancy here, just like that 3rd and 1, get that fullback downhill. You see Kevin Cooper again getting his pads down, opening the lane, and Ontario can do the rest. 220 pounds gets the Volunteers on the board on their initial drive of the game.
New kicker Devin Mathis comes on and gets his first extra point of the season. It is a 7-0 lead for the Tennessee Volunteers. Vanderbilt still has yet to touch the football. When we come back, an opportunity for Warren Norman to set SEC history. He is chasing Herschel Walker. We'll tell you about that when we come back. Welcome back, everyone. The battle for the Volunteer State. Vanderbilt, about 180 miles away in Nashville, making the trip across I-40 here to Knoxville to take on the Tennessee Volunteers. Final regular season game for the Commodores, and a final chance for Warren Norman to surpass greatness. He needs 17 more all-purpose yards to break a vaunted record set for freshmen in the SEC. Herschel Walker, 1,805 all-purpose yards for the Georgia Bulldogs, but Warren Norman, with this kickoff return, he could pass Herschel Walker. All-purpose yards, or receiving yards, rush yards, as well as punt return yards and kickoff return yards. Chad Cunningham kicks it off. This is Norman. Starts at the 6-yard line. And Norman spilled at the 19. Good open field tackle. Made by Denarius Moore. Moore, one of the better receivers for Tennessee on special teams, makes a nice open field tackle. And here is Mackenzie Adams, fifth-year senior from Tulsa.
I saw a bunch of his teammates on the field pregame. I asked his lineman, give me one word to describe Mackenzie Adams. And all of them said simply, gamer. Loves to play the game of football.
Third start of the season for Adams. 12th career start. Hands it off to Norman, and Norman swarmed in the backfield. Big Dan Williams gets him for a loss of 2.
And along with 710 rushing yards this season, Moore Norman also tied an SEC record with 3 kickoff return touchdowns. Roderick Stewart is a very slippery defensive end, and we talked about Chris Marv and his prowess as a tackler.
Second and 12, another give to Norman. This time able to get back to the original line of scrimmage. Herman Lathers getting his 3rd consecutive start at middle backer, makes the stop.
And unlike Tennessee, who was able to establish that run game and get into 3rd and short situations, 3rd and 1, exactly what Vanderbilt does not want tonight, 3rd and extra long situations.
Vanderbilt, their offensive starters on the top of your screen. They have really struggled offensively in league play. Just 4 touchdowns offensively for the Commodores in 7 conference games. 3rd down and 9. Adams, quick slant, complete, but short of 1st down yard. Pickup of 7. Turner Wimberly, his 10th catch of the season, but a quick tackle made by Art Evans.
That's exactly why you want to avoid those 3rd and 9. A safe call by offensive coordinator Ted King. Get the ball out of McKenzie's hands early. Bobby Johnson talked to us this week about field position, about staying on the field. Vanderbilt dead last in all of college football. 120 out of 120 in time of possession. Does not want to keep his defense on the field a whole lot tonight.
78th punt of the season for Brett Upson. That is the most in all of college football. This is the FBS level. That one a punt of 34 yards. We'll take a timeout when we come back. Tennessee will have the ball for the 2nd time. Minutes 45 seconds in the books. Tennessee already on top of Vandy, 7-0. In case you missed how they scored moments ago, Brock, give us a look.
Yeah, take a good look at your fullback Kevin Cooper and your and just productive in the run game and the passing. When you can run it, you set up that play action pass, which finish off with this goal line run, which we'll take a look at here. Both fullback Kevin Cooper and left tackle Chris Scott, who both get downhill and establishing the line of scrimmage. That's what Lane Kiffin wants. Not the fancy dink and dunk passes or the shots down the field. All good offensive coordinators understand to set up that play action, to set up that pass, to slow down a defense, you need to win at the line of scrimmage. Tennessee had a tough time a week ago against Ole Miss. Not a tough time on that first drive.
Compton play fake. Wants a bunch. Incomplete, trying to get it to Denarius Moore. 2nd down and 10. Let's go to the studio. Lowell Galindo standing by. Lowell, what's going on?
Well, we had a wild finish between LSU and Ole Miss. 9 seconds left. LSU down 2. It's 4th and 26. Jordan Jefferson throws it into a crowd, and Terrence Tolliver brings it down inside the 10-yard line. 1 second left. Not only does LSU not get the snap off, they tried to spike it as well, and they lose by 2, Eric.
Oh, my goodness. Thank you, Lowell. Wow. Ole Miss, after their win a week ago against Vandy, continues with the good vibes. Win it by the skin of their teeth. Pass complete to Gerald Jones, a pickup of 17.
Really nice timing on that deep comeback. Gerald Jones, Denarius Moore, 2 receivers that started this season slow. They were both beat up with injuries. You look at their production, it's very much mirrored Jonathan Crompton. They've grown together as this season has progressed. And Jonathan Crompton playing as well as any quarterback in the SEC.
two tight ends in the game, and they go to the ground. Hardesty. On the left side. Good gain for Hardesty. A pickup of 9, maybe 10. I think he's just short of the marker.
A really nice block out there by his tight end, Luke Stocker, number 88, 6'6", 240-pound, redshirt junior. Huge upside. Lane telling us he believes he has first-round talent. Does a nice job on the edge there, controlling, once again, those Vanderbilt linebackers and opening lanes for Hardesty.
Two tight ends once again in the game. Hardesty gets the first down, crosses the 30, and gets to the 26. Greg Billinger with the tackle, but another pickup of 9.
Tennessee offensively had been red hot before they traveled to Ole Miss a week ago, and even in the first half played really well. The last week in the second half, Ole Miss front four, their penetration, those big guys in the middle of the line really took the game over. Lane made a point this week to get back to some of the basics, get back to running the football, and you're seeing it here in the first 10 minutes of this game tonight.
Torian Poole into the game, moves out of the backfield, goes in motion wide left. Crompton with tons of time on his check down, trying to get it to Jones. Pass a little bit too high and a little bit outside. So far, Tennessee has been able to run the football very effectively against Vandy. And I guess that's to be expected. Vandy's defense has been somewhat porous this year against ground attacks, giving up close to 200 game yards a game on the ground. That's last in the SEC.
And it's been big plays. You see Bobby Johnson there. Good shot of Bruce Fowler, his longtime defensive coordinator, limiting the explosive plays. A lot more of them this year for Vanderbilt offensive foes.
Play action. Too strong. Good defense played out in the flat on Denarius Moore.
I can't tell you how big a loss. Bobby Johnson didn't talk about it this week, but you're talking about Myron Lewis and Patrick Benoit, two of your best defensive players, both out tonight with injuries. Really been the story of this season. A lot of hard luck injuries, played a lot of youth. They've been in many games, had a chance in three or four games this season. Overtime loss at Army, just unable to make those plays, those decisive plays, those game-changing plays to find a way to win this season.
Seven consecutive losses for Vanderbilt coming down the stretch. Crompton over the middle, complete to Moore, and Moore tripped up at the 20-yard line, may have tripped on his own feet. Pickup of 6, Brent Trice was in the area. Now, these are the injuries that have been really crippling for Vandy. Benoit not playing today with a concussion. Hamilton ripped his pectoral against LSU and actually played the second half of the game. Larry Smith, the starting quarterback, out for the last couple. And James Williams, one of the better offensive tackles in the SEC. He was injured and out for the year early in the campaign in Baton Rouge against LSU. They're going to go for it here. It's fourth down at 4, and the offense stays on the field. Crompton out of the shotgun. Slant complete. They've got the first down. Down to the 10-yard line. Torian Poole, back on running back, used in the slot, makes the grab.
And that's smart football. That's going against Myron Lewis's replacement, Jamie Graham, a guy that's played some nickelback, played receiver this season. You're finding your one-on-one, man-on-man matchup and taking advantage of it. A fourth down call also predicated on the field goal problems and kicking problems Tennessee has had this season.
Tennessee just 11 for 18 on field goals. They had a whole bunch of them blocked in recent weeks. Hardesty back in the game as the single setback behind Crompton. Two tight end formation. Incomplete, looking for Denarius Moore.
And we've seen a lot of quarterbacks this year in the SEC. And the one thing that jumps out to you about Jonathan Crompton, we saw him break all the records. First half records, 5 touchdowns, 300 yards against Memphis. But what jumps out to me, it's his decision making. He's not hesitating at any point. He's hitting his third step, his fifth step. You know, his play action fake, and the ball is coming out. Just a lot of awareness, knowing and understanding where he wants to deliver the ball. Stark contrast to a season ago.
Now gone 128 passes without an interception. Crompton again to the end zone. Incomplete. Senior Quentin Hancock had it bounce up in the air, and there is a flag down on the field.
It's going to be a holding call against Tennessee. And nice coverage there by Casey Hayward, getting his hand in at that last moment against the senior Hancock.
This is our referee, Steve
holding
Shaw.
On the offense, number 65. 10-yard penalty for the previous punt. Repeat, second down.
And I really like Casey Hayward. He's just a true sophomore, one of three Commodores a year ago to play as true freshman. Seven this season have had to play for Bobby Johnson's crew. You can see Lane Kiffin, he doesn't particularly like that call. But Casey Hayward, very, very scrappy. He's learned a lot from Myron Lewis on the other side. He's got a bright future with two more years ahead of him.
10th play of this drive, second down at 20. Ball spotted back on the 21-yard line. Hardesty caught from behind. John Stokes, the junior from Memphis.
The versatile John Stokes, actually a strong side linebacker. He's moving over tonight and playing that weak side linebacker position vacated by the injured, concussed Patrick Benoit. And John Stokes, a very, very bright guy, already admitted to the Vanderbilt Medical School, was a District 4 academic All-American for the second time. Moving positions, no challenge for John Stokes.
Third down and 17. Balls can get a first down at the 1 yard line. And they try a running play to Hardesty. And it almost worked. Gets to the 8 yard line. Brent Price jumped on his back. Pick up the 10. It'll bring up fourth down. And now who will be the kicker? A little bit of drama. Kicker for the bulk of the season had been Daniel Lincoln. We'd also seen a little bit of Chad Cunningham. But now, recently added to the team just a couple of days ago, is Devin Mathis. Kind of wonder where he got the jersey from. Maybe he had to buy it at the bookstore. But he just joined the team earlier this week, open tryout, and he's going to try from 25 yards. Devin Mathis, where you been all season? The Vols will take it. Their lead swells to 10. Vanderbilt has the football. When we come back, you're watching the SEC on ESPN. You know, don't go to sleep on Warren Norman. Warren Norman has got a chance to make history right now as Vanderbilt trying to get back in this game, down 10-0 against Tennessee. Warren Norman going back for this kickoff return. He needs 3 yards on this return to break the SEC record for freshmen in all-purpose yards. The previous holder, good old number 34. He was pretty good. Herschel Walker.
Yeah, they're built a little differently. Warren just 5'9" and 185 pounds, but pretty impressive body of work as a true freshman this season for Vanderbilt.
Chad Cunningham will kick it off. Spinning kick. Norman's going to get a chance. Catches it at the 16. He's broken the record. And now he's getting greedy. He takes it all the way out to the 38-yard line. How about that? A tip of the cap to the 19-year-old from Stone Mountain, Georgia. He is now the SEC's all-time leader for freshman all-purpose yards. All-purpose yards are receiving yards, rushing yards, punt return yards, and kickoff return yards.
Volunteer fans will probably know the other name, and as I said earlier, very impressive this season. 3 kickoff returns for touchdowns. Only one other guy in the history of the SEC did that in a single season, and that was the old Volunteer, Willie Gault.
He could move it. Zach Stacy, another freshman, deep in the backfield next to Mackenzie Adams. They fake it to Stacy and hit a man wide open in the flat, Colin Ashley. He gets the first down and gets to the 50-yard line, a 13-yard pickup. Dennis Rogan on the stop.
And unlike Tennessee, who on the other side can line up and run it downhill at you, this is what Vanderbilt's going to have to do tonight. A little bit of a wrinkle here. You run that zone read, the option there for Mackenzie Adams to hand it, to keep it, and the third option then to dump it off to Ashley for the first down.
Fresh set of downs. Mackenzie Adams, fifth-year senior quarterback, out of the shotgun. Snap is high. Handoff to Stacy, and Stacy gets into the secondary, inside the 30, down to the 28. Tackle made by Dennis Rogan, but another big gainer, this time 21 yards.
And that, unfortunately, for the 100,000 sitting here tonight, looks a lot like what Ole Miss did a week ago. Just a nice zone concept, a missed tackle by the linebackers, lots of missed tackles against the Rebels last weekend.
Quick snap, and Zach Stacy this time is spun down, not nearly as productive of a play, just a gain of two.
You talk about the injuries for Vanderbilt. Tennessee has overcome many of them defensively as well. On their third inside linebacker, their corner Dennis Rogan has had to flip over and play free safety tonight. Lots of moving pieces for the Volunteers on defense as well.
Yeah, Anthony Anderson, just saw him, number 36. He got the start at the quarterback spot. Second down and nine. Warren Norman has checked back into the game in place of Zach Stacy. Designed quarterback run, and Adams gets out to the 20-yard line, tackled by Herman Lathers. A pickup of six that'll bring up third down and one. And last week, how about the day for Dexter McCluster? 282 rush yards and four touchdowns. Those 282 rushing yards, the most ever by a Tennessee opponent.
And Monty Kiffin really talked about his defense, letting Dexter McCluster out the gate one too many times. Poor angles, poor technique, poor tackling. But his defense is all built around keeping those backs around the rest of the linebackers and defense alignment. And last week, Dexter McCluster got out one too many times.
Power formation here for Vanderbilt, and they run the football. Norman trying to get to the edge, has the first down. Now it's going to get interesting. Vanderbilt has a first down in the red zone, where they are dead last in the SEC this year offensively.
32 times this offense has been in the red zone, just 13 touchdowns, barely over 40%. Frankly, it's led to many of their losses, many close games this season, not been able to win one-on-one matchups. When the field condenses in the red zone, you must have your receivers win in one-on-one situations.
They want to throw it. Adams to the end zone. Incomplete. Looking for Udom Uma. We've talked a lot about the struggles this year for Vanderbilt. Hadn't always been this way. They were very good a year ago. Bobby Johnson's team was 7-6 on the season, and that included a win in the Music City Bowl against Boston College. The first bowl win for Vanderbilt in 53 years. Came into the season with some expectations, and with the early injuries and the offensive troubles, you know, their hopes dashed fairly quickly. They fake the end around and give it to Norman, who's swallowed after a pickup of one.
That's a better play up front for Tennessee. Imani Kiffin's defense is very strict in its gap control. He calls it fits. Everyone has to have their fit. There's a responsibility for each little area of the field, each of those gaps. And last week, very, very poor in their fits. That led to the poor tackling. That led to Dexter McCluster's career day. Expectations much higher for their performance tonight.
Pass is high through the hands of John Cole, and it was almost picked off. Anthony Anderson almost grabbed that carom.
Talked about little wrinkles that you've got to run, and you see some of the fundamentals get away from McKenzie Adams there. He's dropping back, trying to influence those Tennessee defenders. They're not buying it. Unfortunate that that ball isn't captured by the sophomore Anthony Anderson, making the first start of his career.
So Ryan Fowler will attempt a 31-yarder. He's made eight of his last nine on the season. Nine of his last 10. So the Commodores on the board. They trailed Tennessee 10-3, 2:18 remaining. First quarter, you're watching the SEC on ESPN. 10-3 is our score. Volunteers on top of Commodores, 2:18 remaining in the first quarter of play. Moments before the game began, we had a chance to go out and about and ask these Tennessee fans what they think of this rivalry here in the Volunteer State.
The UT-Vandy rivalry is a huge in-state rivalry. It's become much more competitive in the last few years.
Go Vols!
Vanderbilt's our interstate rival. It's the only interstate rival we really have. They always come here to play in Knoxville, and we always look forward to beating them.
In-state rivalry, bragging rights all year long.
I believe the Vandy-UT rivalry is all about pride and about what is best for Tennessee and shows the best of Tennessee.
That was a damn good answer. I tell you what, y'all don't put that on TV, I'll tell you what.
Love it. This is the 103rd meeting between these two schools. It began back in 1892. And when they first played in 1892, they actually played two games that year. Vanderbilt winning both times, one in October and one in November. David Oku is the second return to the ball game, and he is stuck at the 24-yard line. Return of 23 yards. Let's go back to the studio. Lowell, what's going on?
Well, Eric, this is what's going on in the big game. It's one of those it's Heisman guys at this point in the season. Toby Gerhart for Stanford, rumbling through that California defense. He goes 61 yards on the opening drive of the game. Cardinal with the lead, 7-0. Eric, back to you.
That Gerhart kid, he's a tough customer.
Great return, number 18. Finally, it's 10 yards from end of the run. First and 10.
I had a chance yesterday to talk to Todd McShay at ESPN. Does a lot of evaluation in the NFL draft. I said, where does Toby Gerhart fit? Everyone now, he's in the Heisman conversation. You see him productive against USC. And he said, you know, he's definitely going to be a first-day guy. It'll be interesting to see what he runs at the combine. That will be very dependent on how highly he's drafted come April.
I haven't seen too many guys catching from behind. First down run. Across the 20, out to the 24-yard line, a pickup of 11 yards. Montario Hardesty has been the workhorse for the Vols here in this first quarter. He has run like this is his final game here at Neyland Stadium.
Over 7 yards a carry, doing a nice job of squaring his shoulders within this zone blocking scheme, whether you've got a fullback in front of him, and sometimes without a fullback, you want those running backs to get downhill. Ontario doing a fabulous job in the first quarter.
Two tight ends, and they throw it. Gerald Jones makes the first man miss and gets out to the 47-yard line. 22 more yards.
And that's a little bit more of that recognition that I was talking about with Jonathan Crompton, an awareness of the big picture of what's going on. Vanderbilt walks eight guys down into the box. You see Sean Richardson, the safety. That leaves it one-on-one with your receiver and corner. Watch that safety crawl into the box. That's a run play. That's a designed run play to the weak side. Crompton has the opportunity to pull up and hit his receiver in the one-on-one, and Jones does the rest.
This time, not much doing for Hardesty. Rock for the majority of this first quarter. We have seen Tennessee come out with two tight ends in the formation. Are you surprised that Lane Kiffin has had this power formation in mind for the first 15 minutes?
No, I don't think so. When you've got a defense that's missing some linebackers, and these Vanderbilt linebackers are their tacklers, three of the top 12 in all the SEC are Benoit, Marv, and Brent Trice. When you got one of those guys out, you want to take advantage and see what the backups can do in that situation.
Once again, Cottom and Stocker in, the two tight ends. And they throw in this formation, complete to Teague. True freshman from Harris, Tennessee. His 13th catch of the season, gains 3 yards.
Now that's the exact same read by Crompton, but you see the difference into the boundary. There's just not as much room there. Those are designed run plays, and he always has the option if he sees one-on-one coverage, off coverage by that cornerback, to make that quick throw outside. In that case, a little bit too tight into the boundary, and the safety able to also come in and make a play on the tackle.
On a third down at 5, Bryce Brown checks into the game. True freshman from Wichita. Big time talent. He's got the football. And he's going to be short of the first down marker. Jamie Graham makes the tackle at the 45-yard line. It'll be 4th down and 1. It's going to be a decision for Tennessee, but I think they're going to have some time to think it over. Lane Kiffin's going to get a break between quarters to think what he wants to do. We've played 15 minutes here in Knoxville. 10-3. Lane Kiffin and the Vols on top of the Vanderbilt Commodores. You're watching the SEC on ESPN. You're watching the SEC on ESPN. ESPNU College Football Primetime presented by Citi. About 2 hours before the game, the Vol walk. Players coming into Neyland Stadium for the final time here in the 2009 regular season. Packed house. Just a gorgeous Saturday evening. On fourth down and two, it's a fake. It's a fake punt, and it works. There's a flag down on the field as Kevin Cooper, the upback, actually took the direct snap and tried to get the first down running. It's going to depend on the penalty. That's the spot on the field that you don't mind taking a chance and faking it. And Lane Kiffin took that opportunity, but the penalty may
holding
actually
on the offense.
Yeah.
Number six, 10-yard penalty on the foul. Feet, fourth down.
Now they're going to have to punt.
And that's Denarius Moore once again. You'll see with Lane Kiffin. You saw Kevin Cooper. You actually see lots of Eric Berry as well. They're going to call Denarius Moore at hand. Actually, I think they're going to actually call that on Eric Berry where the flag was thrown. But lots of starters on the special team. Some of the depth this year, you're playing a couple walk-ons. You're playing redshirt freshmen and true freshmen. Depth has been an issue on some of the special teams. Lane Kiffin's made a decision. I'm going to play a lot of my starters there as well.
So now Cunningham will punt it away. High spiraling kick. Oh, my goodness. Zach Stacy fields it at the one. And Stacy making something out of nothing gets out to the 16. There is a flag on the play. Wow, talk about a true freshman quite possibly making a huge mistake. Stacy fielding at the one and actually going into the end zone. You never see that.
And Bobby Johnson is fired up. You can see him very animated and vocal.
During the return, holding on the receiving team for 29. Philly is half the distance goal, first down.
And Alex Washington, a fifth-year senior, is the normal punt returner tonight. Vanderbilt tried to get their true freshman, another explosive playmaker in Zach Stacy, into the game, but it's basic 101 football, Zach, and that is put your feet at the 10-yard line, and if that ball is sailing over your head, you have got to allow that to go into the end zone. Now you put your offense in very unfavorable field position.
Well, it would have been the longest punt return in the history of college football. It would have been a 100-yard punt return. Can't do anything more than that. After the penalty, ball spotted at the 8-yard line. Mackenzie Adams takes the snap and swarmed in the backfield. Warren Norman just swallowed up by Chris Walker.
I talked about awareness earlier with Jonathan Crompton as a fifth-year senior, seeing the whole picture. Zach Stacy, the true freshman, he cannot on that punt return, and now he's put his offense in a dire situation. Awfully dangerous, poor snap from Vierling. It sets off the whole time of the play, and too much speed from the edge out of Chris Walker.
Hey, you need to block Chris Walker. Again on the ground, and this time Norman finds space. First down and more out to the 25.
He has really nice feet. We have seen Vanderbilt a number of times this season, and every time I see Warren Norman, I'm blown away by his vision and his feet as just a true freshman. Excellent patience, and once again, Vanderbilt or Tennessee not getting into their proper gaps, into those fits that Monty Kiffin talks about. Too many defenders there swallowed up by the Vanderbilt offensive line.
Yeah, right guard Eric Hensley just pancaked Rico McCoy. That was the big block on that run. Again, Norman. Pick up a three.
Looks like a penalty flag possibly came in here late as well.
That's a huge flag if it is. I think that's someone's uniform.
After the play was over, personal foul on the defense, number 14. Penalty will be enforced 15 yards from the end of the run. Includes an automatic first down.
That flag looks like the size of a placemat.
And that was Eric Berry very late. He just sticks his shoulder into the Vanderbilt offensive player. And anytime you're around those piles and you see someone come flying in, often, whether it's a small flag or a very large flag, you're going to draw the attention of those referees.
Eric Berry, just a junior, but quite possibly playing his final home game. There are whispers that he is going to be a top five pick in the NFL draft come springtime, should he so choose to turn professional. Completes the pass. Udom Uma with the grab. Gain of 7 on first down.
And that's exactly what Vanderbilt needs on first down. Get a gain. Get into favorable second and third down situations that will help you possess this football, which they need to do tonight.
And remember, Vanderbilt dead last among all 120 FBS teams in time of possession. 25 minutes and change. They possess it on average per ball game. Adams keeps it open. John Cole, team's leading receiver, picks up 7 and gets another first down for the Commodores. Eric Berry made the tackle, but not before Cole moves the sticks.
That's a nice little wrinkle. I think Chip Kelly at Oregon, so innovative with these wrinkles. He's ahead of the curve, getting those receivers in that zone read game that teams are liking to run. Get them out there in space as well as a third option. We've seen that now twice tonight for Vanderbilt. Kenzie Adams has the option to hand the ball off, keep it. And if Tennessee commits to him, you have that little receiver open in space as well.
Good time, gets it to Norman. Norman makes the first man miss and gets inside the 30. Norman's fun to watch. Gain of 16.
You see Vanderbilt gaining the confidence as they're moving these chains. That's inside linebacker Herman Lathers, number 34. He gets knocked off, actually. Almost looks like a run play with the two Commodores converging on him. Herman unable to get out into his zone responsibility, and Norman makes him pay.
Man down on the 25-yard line. That's Art Evans, sophomore cornerback. Told you that they're already thin in that defensive backfield.
One of the guys they really miss is true freshman Jansen Jackson. Talking to Lane yesterday, I asked him how much of a distraction those suspensions were and ultimately having to kick two players off of his team, two freshmen. He said the biggest blow has really been the production from Jansen Jackson. He was well on his way to being a freshman All-American, a very physical force. He right now, out of those three, the lone student-athlete still on this team, not taking part in team activities. But they've gone a few different directions since that suspension. They've gone with Prentice Wagner, the redshirt freshman. He has struggled the last few weeks. They moved Dennis Rogan, the starting corner, to that free safety spot. Elevate Anthony Anderson, the true sophomore, into his first start. So Tennessee is not hearing anything about Vanderbilt's injury situation. They've had their own battles of personnel as well.
Kennard Reeves now into the game for the first time as the running back in the backfield next to Mackenzie Adams. Reeves wears number 28, junior from Duluth, Georgia. Three receivers in the game for the Commodore. Tight end is Brandon Barden. And they look for Barden. Off his fingertips. But maybe there's a reason for that. There's a flag down in the defensive backfield. All season long, Vanderbilt has tried to use that tight end when they get close to the goal line.
Hey. pass interference on the defense, number 5. The penalty will place the ball, respond to the foul, and includes an automatic first down.
Senior Rico McCoy.
And Brandon Burton, a nice target at 6'5", actually the team's second leading receiver. And the penalty would have been before that replay. Let's see if he gets his hand in. We can't see it either in either of those replays, but the referees obviously saw some contact to draw the play.
So Vanderbilt in the red zone for the second time today. Warren Norman gets inside the 10 to the 9. Rico McCoy with the tackle, but not before a 5-yard gain.
Rico McCoy has been banged up as well. Battled a knee injury. The staff, coaching staff, telling us yesterday that he probably should have come out of that Ole Miss game playing on one leg. But they're just down so many bodies at that position as well. He's got to gut it out.
Good drive for the Commodores. This will be their 9th play. Remember, they started deep inside their own 20. After the penalty on the punt return. Hand off to Norman. Very patient. And it pays off. He gets inside the 5, down to the 4. McCoy saved the touchdown.
Yeah, we have seen Vanderbilt a number of times this season, and not just Warren Norman. The other area of this team that jumps out are their 4 redshirt seniors up front. They're very athletic. You see the movement there again by the center, Bradley Beerling, pulling in front on that play. Welch, Custer, Beerling, Hensley, all redshirt seniors have played over 200 games in their career. So this setting tonight, not intimidating them a bit.
Nanny quick to the line on 3rd down and 1. Pitch out wide. Reeves gets the first down. They like Kennard Reese for his power running, and he gets the first down.
I see a Tennessee defense, much like on film last week against Ole Miss. These linebackers are hesitating just a bit. Rico McCoy is not 100%. Herman Lathers is a redshirt freshman. He's making just his 3rd start of his career. As these guys grow in their play, they'll not hesitate. They'll hit these plays downhill. But right now, Vanderbilt getting the better of these linebackers.
Commodores, they want a touchdown. Don't want to settle for a field goal. Option. And Adams falls down.
And that just epitomizes the struggles of Vanderbilt in the red zone. Ted Kaine, offensive coordinator, asked him very specifically before the game, what are some of the problems in the red zone? He said, Brock, it's tip balls, it's drop balls, it's guys slipping. Just the plays are there and you're not able to make it. And that play exactly typifies what Ted was telling me before the game has been problematic for them all year long.
Needs the longer cleats. Adams on the rollout. Caught. Touchdown. Ryan Van Rensburg. Just the 5th offensive touchdown in SEC play for the Commodores.
If you're Tennessee, you better be really careful about letting these hungry Commodores stay alive. 0-7. They've gone through a lot of adversity this season. They're hungry for their first SEC win. And you see the outpouring of emotion right now and confidence that this offense is starting the game. I like this call from Ted Kaine. Nice little wrinkle. You're at the 1-yard line. You're probably not going to line up and just run it. That's a touchdown. They'll take a look at replay of this. I think that's clearly a touchdown. But that's a good call. You get Mackenzie Adams, who can run. Get him in a pass run situation. And Van Rensburg does a nice job. Both he and the other tight end, 82, Justin Green there. I thought early in the route, too close together. They finally gained some of that separation. Put Rico McCoy in a 2-on-1 coverage. And Vanderbilt and Van Rensburg, the South African rugby player, makes him pay.
First touchdown on the season for Van Rensburg.
Further review, on the field stands as call. Touchdown.
It was Ben Martin who came up and gave Van Rensburg a lick, but he'll take a lick and get 6 anytime. So pending extra point, we've got a ball game. Ryan Fowler, chance to tie it up at 10. A 10-10 tie. Don't go to sleep on Vanderbilt. Their highest point total in SEC play so far this year is 13 points. They've got 10 right now. Final SEC game of the season for Vanderbilt. And just now, the offense getting into gear. An 11-play, 92-yard drive capped off by a touchdown grab, Ryan Van Rensburg.
And what a great story. The former native of South Africa does a nice job here. You'll see these guys, they'll get up near that line of scrimmage. That's called a sneak route, a concept where you want to hide him from that defense. The action goes away. He sneaks between the linemen. And you can see Rico McCoy limping. Ben Martin in a two-on-one situation, can't cover it up. The former rugby player getting into space and making the play for Vanderbilt.
Commodores have come to play. They've made the 180-mile trip from Nashville to Knoxville. And they have tied this ball game up at 10 apiece. Fowler, kickoff is short. Bryce Brown, freshman, on the return, and he has his knees taken out at the 27-yard line. Let's go to the studio. Lowell, what's going on?
Eric Moore, Toby Gerhart. That is what's going on, much to the dismay of the California Golden Bears. That's a two-yard rumble, an absolute rumble for a touchdown, and the Cardinal leading 14-0 still in the first quarter. Eric?
Thank you so much. Toby Gerhart doesn't have to do much to be among the all-time greats in college football with the first name of Toby. Do you agree? Jonathan Crumpton underneath center takes the handoff. Pocket collapses. He gets out of dodge. And Crumpton dives a little bit short of the first down, a pickup of 9. I've just been handed a note. That touchdown drive for Vanderbilt, the longest touchdown drive of the, check that, the longest scoring drive of the season. 92 yards from start to finish.
Yeah, Zach Stacy's going to go to Bobby Johnson and say, what's the big deal? I told you, you know, we had success because I caught the ball at the 1 yard line.
Second down and 1. The entire playbook is open here. Let's see how aggressive the balls get. Not very. On the ground, right tackle run, and Steven Stone blows it up. Third down and 2. They actually lose a yard. Steven Stone, fifth year senior, missing the bulk of the season with a bad foot. Back in since the South Carolina game a couple of weeks ago. Brock Hewitt, I'm Eric Collins. We're at Neyland Stadium. Senior day. In-state rivalry game, Tennessee and Vanderbilt. 10-10 tie. Balls have the football. They want to stay on the field offensively. Hardesty goes straight up the gut and gets the first down. 9-yard rip. Sean Richardson with the tackle.
Nothing fancy there, just a zone concept. That's what Tennessee loves to do. Last week, Ole Miss, they had a lot of penetration that blew those plays up in the backfield. Tonight, the Solons brothers doing a better job at center and guard, and Chris Scott, you'll often find they'll run behind him on that left side, opening the lane for Hardesty.
Deep back, Bryce Brown. They put the tight end Stocker in motion. Fake to Brown. Incomplete. Low and outside, trying to get it to Gerald Jones. What's been the big difference for Crumpton? Why have the numbers improved so much in recent weeks?
Now, Lane told us a few weeks ago he really felt like it was not on Crumpton early this season, that actually he probably put receivers in there before they were ready, that the whole group had to learn this system, and as the receivers and tight ends and everyone's gotten on the same page, you've seen Jonathan's stats improve. But I just really like the decisiveness in which he's playing the position.
This time they do hand it off, and Brown gets out to the 48-yard line and pick up a 4. ESPNU's coverage of college football continues on ESPNU later tonight. The Nevada Wolfpack taking on the Aggies of New Mexico State. College football primetime presented by Citi on ESPNU and ESPNU HD. That's tonight at 10:30 Eastern Time.
And if Luke Lippincott in that game can get to 1,000 yards, how about the Wolfpack with 3 1,000-yard rushers? And remember, they will travel up to Boise and test the Broncos a week from now.
Out of Chris Ault's pistol offense. Kind of different, you know, they accentuate that run game. Do a great job of it. On third down, pitch and catch is good. Denarius Moore gets a first down.
He asked earlier about Crompton, and the one thing about this system is there's got to be a trust between quarterback and receiver. If you're asking your quarterback to throw it on rhythm and throw it on time, he's got to trust that his wideouts are going to get to the spot in which he wants to throw it. On these slant routes in particular, and Denarius Moore a few times tonight, it's gained the trust of his quarterback, getting inside leverage on those defensive backs and converting on those critical third downs.
Hardesty with the ball. Pickup of 7. Richardson, another tackle. Elaine Kiffin, just 34 years of age, youngest head coach in all of Division 1A football. You talk to virtually anyone here in Knoxville, and they will say that they are ecstatic with the direction of this program. They're officially a mediocre team. They're 5-5, but just the way in which this program has gone about their business on the field this season. Losses have been respectable, and some of the wins have been impressive.
There's an audible from Crompton.
Second down, in the flat, complete to Quentin Hancock, and the senior gets to the 15-yard line.
You know, I talked about that play in the red zone. It exemplified the struggles of Vanderbilt. Well, that play right there talks exactly to Jonathan Crompton's development. He gets to the line of scrimmage. They have, again, another run called. He audibles, slows down the motion, says, easy, easy, I'm going to check this play. I see one-on-one coverage, and I'm going to check to a protection and let my receivers keep making plays. That's heady, heady stuff from your fifth-year senior.
Crompton has his pass batted down. Adam Smotherman smothers it.
And this is a big series for Vanderbilt defensively. Your offense is giving you a little life. Your defense, you sat on that bench for nearly 5 minutes. You see Bruce Fowler there. I really respect the job that he does. A very sound defensive plan. You talk to any coach he goes against, and every single one of them says, rarely is Vanderbilt out of position, very well coached, into the details. But this is big for Vanderbilt defensively if they can hold Tennessee to a field goal.
10th play of the drive. On the ground, Bryce Brown to the 11.
I was a stickler this week with these coaches because you hear that a lot. And you hear analysts say, well, they're sound defensively. They're very sound defensively. Well, what does that mean? And when I was pressing Jim Chaney, the offensive coordinator for Lane Kiffin at Tennessee, he said simply they don't get out of position. They're never aligned incorrectly. They understand the nature of the defense and the little details to set each other up to make plays.
Third down and 6. And a whistle. Blow the play dead. It's a timeout called for. And received. Vanderbilt gets the timeout. They were not happy with the way they were lined up defensively. Bobby Johnson looks on. His team needs a big stop here on third down. You're watching the SEC on ESPN. 3:25 remaining. First half, Jonathan Crompton marking the play out in the huddle. It's a third down and 6 for the Volunteers. They're tied with Vandy at 10. Ontario Hardesty is the back of the backfield next to Crompton. 4 receivers in the game. Crompton steps up, running out of time to the end zone. Touchdown! Denarius Moore comes up with it. I don't know how he hung on to that football.
Tennessee quickly trying to get out here and get this PAT set before anybody can take a look. We'll take a look quickly. Tough to see with that view. Three on two on both sides. Plenty of defenders there for Vanderbilt. Crumpton keeps the play alive. And Brent Trice twice in both of these views. His body, number 11, blocks. Let me get a better look here. Ooh, that is a tough call. That is called a touchdown on the field, an indisputable visual evidence to turn that over. I don't see the ball move at any point. I do think this is our best look. You tell me, do you see the ball move or does he get his hand underneath? And to me, he looks like he controls that catch all the way through contact with the ground. That's going to be a touchdown.
After further review, field is confirmed. Touchdown.
And you saw the three-on-two look. They did it on both sides to the receivers. That is all on Jonathan Crompton. Buying time, scrambling to his left, and giving Denarius an opportunity to separate from that coverage and score the critical touchdown for the Volunteers.
Sixth receiving touchdown of the season for Denarius Moore. And Devin Mathis gets the extra point through. Jonathan Crompton playing in his final home game here at Neyland Stadium. Touchdown number 24 for the senior from Waynesville, North Carolina. Welcome back, everyone. Neyland Stadium here in Knoxville, Tennessee. Jonathan Crompton has just thrown a touchdown pass to Denarius Moore, and it is a 17-10 lead for the Vols.
Now, as a quarterback, you're going to see three defenders on your two. This is a simple little route concept. You're trying to run the flat in the corners. A quarterback, when you see that three on two, you immediately know, I've got to buy a little time. I'm outnumbered and I'm out leveraged, but if I buy time in that pocket, I can allow my receivers to make a play, and that's exactly what Crompton and Moore do. So some of the headiness, some of that ability to read the bigger picture. I guarantee you, last year, 2 years ago, you know, that awareness level isn't anywhere near where it is right now for Jonathan Crompton. That's why now 17 touchdowns to two interceptions over the last six games.
Cunningham kicks it off deep. Zach Stacy will get a crack at it, and they reverse it. Out to the 15-yard line, out to the 20. Still on his feet, out to the 29-yard line goes Trey Wilson. Backup defensive back. Let's go to the studio. Lowell.
Well, Aaron, coming up at the half, LSU runs out of time against Ole Miss. We will let you know what in the world was Les Miles thinking at the end of the game. We'll check in on number one and number two, Florida and Bama. And Colt McCoy plays his last home game, trying to break David Green's record for most wins by starting quarterback. Eric?
Thank you, Lowell. Vanderbilt scored a touchdown last time they had the football. Had a six-minute drive, culminated in the touchdown pass to Ryan Van Rensburg. It was the longest touchdown drive in terms of time of possession for the Commodores all season long. Mackenzie Adams gets it to his tight end, Barton, out to the 44-yard line. 18 yards on first down.
It's a nice little wrinkle once again within this scheme. Instead of the receiver outside, now it's your little tight end running the hitch route. And you can see the production tonight far outweigh what they've done in the SEC this season.
Quick snap. Zach Stacy is hammered. Greg King came down from his linebacker spot and drops him after a pickup of one.
Now, there was some anger in that tackle. You could hear the pads all the way up here. That is what Monty Kiffin wants to see from his linebackers. And Greg, just a true freshman getting after it.
King in the lineup replacing LaMarcus Thompson, who was out with that stinger suffered a week ago down in Oxford, Mississippi. A scary moment. LaMarcus is going to be okay, but not able to give it a go this evening. Second and nine, Adams sprays it out, complete. John Cole, his second grab, a little bit short of the first down marker. Cole is still playing with that broken hand. Doesn't have the splint on anymore, but it's still heavily taped. Only missed one game with a broken hand. And leads the team in catches with a broken hand.
This is a big third down as Vanderbilt will get the ball to start the second half. You don't want to give it back to Tennessee. They've driven down the field three times tonight, two touchdowns and a field goal. Mackenzie Adams and this group, you do everything you can to continue to possess this ball through the first half.
Wouldn't be surprised if they run it here. They do run it. Stacy struggles, going to depend on the spot. Looks like he's got enough. They're going to bring the chains in.
Good shot there, Bobby Johnson. Been a difficult year. Last year, four wins in the SEC. The bowl game win you talked about. Vanderbilt has yet in the history of the school to ever go to back-to-back bowl games. High expectations coming into this year. Lots of injuries, lots of youth, the transition on offense. One good thing, the one positive from this year, though, both Warren Norman and Zach Stacy, who had that carry and ultimately the first down. Two backs who have taken the bumps and the bruises and the beating within the very demanding SEC come out better for it. And they're going to be very good down the road for Bobby Johnson.
Yeah, you saw a shot on the sideline of Larry Smith. He has still got eligibility remaining. Sophomore quarterback from Alabama. He will go into camp next spring as the starting quarterback. But he's still got some time remaining to improve and to work in this offense. This will be the final game of the college career for Mackenzie Adams, taking the snap right now. Fake the handoff. Adams keeps it. Barrels down to the 41-yard line. Lathers on the stop. Pickup of five.
And Bobby Johnson's going to take a timeout here. Think about Mackenzie Adams. He can run. He was a high school 300-meter, 110-meter state champion back in Oklahoma. And you can see tonight, he's watching his counterpart, Crompton, produce. Well, he's having fun playing the game as well.
Bobby Johnson's Vanderbilt Commodores getting greedy here. Final minute of the first half. They scored a touchdown. Last time they had the football, they won another one here. They've got the ball. Second down and five. Ball on the 41-yard line. Mackenzie Adams in his final collegiate game has really led this offense here in the first half. Hasn't made any mistakes. And he has got his team right now knocking on that door against a injury-ravaged Tennessee defense. Adams wants to throw. Stacy has it off the fingertips, incomplete. Third down and five. Top of your screen, you can see those little chiclets. Those represent how many timeouts remain. Underneath Vanderbilt, they've got one timeout remaining. Tennessee, they've got the full three.
You call those chiclets, huh?
Yeah. Insider talk. Third down and five. Turner Wimberly has checked into the game. He is wide to the left of Mackenzie Adams. Adams completes it to the tight end, and Barton goes backwards. Barton was close to the first down marker, tried to get shifty, and lost a couple of yards. It'll be fourth down.
And it's a critical decision, and Bobby Johnson is out on the field weighing this decision. You're right. Barton trying to get out of bounds, salvage that last time out. That's a situation where he needs to do the best he can to plant that foot and try to gain the first down. That's a big call. Remember, Tennessee, all three timeouts.
Dangerous. Kind of surprised they're going for it. Fourth and three. No catch. Cole had it. Then it pops loose. John Cole had it and then lost it.
Yeah, I'm surprised by that call. The struggle you've had at receiver, winning one-on-one. You've done a nice job tonight. But this has been a challenge all year, winning in one-on-one situations. It's a slant route. You've seen Tennessee run many of those on third down as well. Well-thrown ball, just right in the tight coverage. And now you give Tennessee ideal field position, a red-hot quarterback. That's a gutsy call on fourth down, knowing you're going to get it back to start the second half.
Yeah, so the Volunteers will have the football. 35 seconds remaining and all three timeouts. Crompton almost had his head taken off. Gets out of the tackle. and completes it to Hancock. Crofton playing like there's no tomorrow. A pickup of 11. And a late penalty flag comes in. Is this a late hit on the quarterback?
Yeah, you're going to tack 15 more on. This is going to be roughing the passer after Crompton is heroic in his escape.
Personal foul, roughing the passer. Number 56 on the defense. The penalty is 15 yards. It will be entered at the end of the run. It also includes an automatic first down.
Yeah, Zach Stacy, he gambled catching the ball at the one-yard line. Vanderbilt's offense bailed him out, going 95 yards for the touchdown. Bobby Johnson and staff gamble going for it on fourth down. The defense there not only unable to make the sack, but the critical penalty.
Oh, they trumped him on the middle screen. Hardesty inside the 25 to the 21. The blitz was on. It was picked up, and Crompton finds Hardesty for a big-time pickup.
Now, I will say this for Bobby Johnson. He also knows Tennessee's kicking situation, knowing that they're in dire straits in their kicking game as well. That probably played into his decision-making. But how about the call of Lane Kiffin? You're exactly right. Neither team, we haven't seen a lot of blitz from either the Commodores or Tennessee tonight. Bruce Fowler brings John Stokes here, an ideal play to run against the blitz if you can get the ball out of your hands as a quarterback. Tennessee makes him pay.
Tennessee uses their first time out. ESPN use coverage of college basketball. And the O'Reilly Auto Parts Puerto Rico tip-off continues tomorrow, 10:30 a.m. Eastern time. George Mason takes on Indiana, 12:30 Eastern, Georgia Tech and Boston University. And at 5:30 Eastern, the 18th-ranked Dayton Flyers squaring off against Kansas State in the third-place game. The O'Reilly Auto Parts Puerto Rico tip-off on ESPNU tomorrow. Your quick test. Boston University, what's their nickname? Ah, the Terriers, you knew it. Now, 16 seconds remaining.
And unlike LSU earlier today, Tennessee has both their timeouts, the playbook wide, wide open.
Crompton, complete, short gain, Luke Stocker, and they're going to have to call another timeout. What's up with the play call?
I don't mind that call. You know you have two timeouts. Luke Stocker is the guy in one-on-one coverage that can break that tackle and make a play. And we were out at the walkthrough watching Lane Kiffin put his troops through that Friday preparation, and he talks about running this program in a very professional manner. And you watch his walkthrough, it is every bit of an NFL walkthrough. Very crisp, all the guys running through the different route combinations and formation and personnel groups, going through all those different scenarios. And Lane in Tennessee trying to make Vanderbilt pay here for, again, I thought a risky decision at the 40, getting the ball to start the second half. I'd rather pin Tennessee down, get to halftime down just 7. Now Tennessee has a chance to really gain some momentum going to intermission.
Tennessee is using a very green kicker, Devin Mathis, kicking for the first time this year, should they choose to settle for a field goal. Crompton wants to go to the end zone. Touchdown, Tennessee! Stocker came down with it. I don't know how he held on to it. What a grab, Luke Stocker. Touchdown number 4 for the junior.
You're going to see the big fella lined up, standing up in the two-point stance. And how about the athleticism to go up and catch that ball at 6'6" at its high point?
Well, the gamble by Bobby Johnson and Vanderbilt to go for it on 4th down and 3. It doesn't pay off, and the Volunteers march down the field and get another touchdown.
That is why Lane Kiffin said Luke Stocker has first-round capabilities next year. 6'6", 240. And as you see at the next level, those big tight ends that can make plays down the middle of the field. And how about Crompton now? 18 touchdowns to 2 interceptions over the last 7 weeks. 25 on the season. Pushing Ryan Mallett in the SEC for top gun and top numbers. and confidence, whether it be the screen pass, whether it be avoiding the sack, whether it be the little short pass route to the tight end that preceded that play. Every single week now over the last seven, you see Crompton gaining confidence within this system. And any quarterback loves to have that 6'6" target that can make plays on safeties and linebackers and stretch the middle of the field.
Third touchdown for that Volunteer offense here in the first half. Two passing, one rushing. Maybe someday we'll see Lane Kiffin with a smile. He wants to call a timeout. He uses his last timeout. Quick story, Luke Stocker. Lane Kiffin has the basketball coach Bruce Pearl to thank for Luke Stocker's being on this roster. Luke Stocker was a big-time basketball player in high school. He's from the basketball capital of the world. He's from Berea, Kentucky. He was down at a basketball camp presided over by Bruce Pearl, the basketball coach here at UT. And it was mentioned that Luke Stocker is also a football player. Philip Fulmer, longtime football coach, said, hey, you want to run some routes for me? Ran some routes, and on the spot, he was offered a football scholarship, and he has evolved into a starter and a very good top-shelf tight end here in the SEC. But it all began at a basketball camp.
Well, the best tight ends, look at Anthony Gonzalez, a guy in the NFL who's played years and years, was a tremendous basketball player at Cal. Those are the kind of guys you want. 6 foot nine, Marcus Pollard, Indianapolis Colts for a decade in the NFL. Didn't even play college football, played basketball at Butler University.
Antonio Gates. Squib kick, keeping it away from Norman. Picked up by the up back and out to the 46-yard line. That's where the Commodores will stop, as that's the final play of the first half. Offensively, pretty close to perfection for Tennessee. They score 24 points, three touchdowns, and they lead Vanderbilt by a score of 24-10. It began with Hardesty. It was answered by a touchdown by Van Rensburg, but then two more scores before the half draws to a close, and it's a 14-point lead. Now, let's send you to the studio. The SEC on ESPN, the ESPNU College Football Primetime, presented by Citi. 30 minutes in the books, and Tennessee on top of their in-state rival Vanderbilt by a score of 24-10. With Brock Huard, I'm Eric Collins, and now don't give up on Vanderbilt. Believe it or not, in this their eighth SEC game of the season, that was their best offensive first half of the year.
And a very clean half for both teams, but Vanderbilt hanging in there. Mackenzie Adams got life into this offense. And how about Warren Norman breaking Herschel Walker's freshman all-purpose yardage record? And he's not just about kickoff returns. He can get his pass down and break tackle. Vanderbilt up front at times did a very nice job opening those lanes. And this is some of the veteran leadership from Mackenzie Adams. Doesn't panic, continues to buy time, hits Ryan Van Rensburg, and the game was 10-10 at that point. Unfortunately, Tennessee, they can play offense too. And their fifth-year senior, Jonathan Crompton, he got it going. Nearly 300 yards for the Volunteers and two big touchdown passes. And you watch Jonathan Crompton, and you continue to like his awareness of the big picture. Everything going on around him, buying a little time, and here hitting Denarius Moore. End of the first half, knowing he's got a 6'6", 6'6" target. Luke Stocker putting the ball where only he can make a play on it. Two more touchdown passes, that's 25 on the season for Jonathan Crompton. And he continues to get better and better every week.
Tennessee will kick off here in the third quarter. Warren Norman, freshman, gonna take it out of his own end zone. Norman crosses the 20 and gets close to the 25-yard line. In case you missed it in the first half, Warren Norman becoming the all-time freshman leader in all-purpose yards, passing Herschel Walker. Take a look at the first half stats.
Yeah, no turnovers. There were a few penalties, some costly ones, especially the roughing the passer at the end of the half for Vanderbilt. But all in all, if you like offense, you certainly liked a lot of the execution from both of these teams in the first half.
After the play was over, personal foul on the return team, number 58. Half the distance to the goal, first down.
Yeah, not the way you want to start. Second half of play. I think they call that penalty on Colt Nichter. Kenzie Adams making start number 3 here in 2009. Missed on 4 passes, accumulated 80 yards, and threw the touchdown pass to Ryan Van Rensburg. Warren Norman starts behind him in the backfield. They fake it to Norman. Adams, the keeper, hammered down after a pickup of 5. Kenzie Adams playing in his final collegiate game. Commodores on a 7-game losing streak. They will not be bowling this year like they did last year. 2-9 on the season, 0-7 in SEC play. Hand off, Norman. Vanderbilt is the only team in the SEC that has not had a bye week. They've played 12 consecutive weeks, and this will be it. They'll spend Thanksgiving at their homes and regroup, play spring football. That'll be the next time that Bobby Johnson will be practicing with this team. Third and 1. Play clock down to 6. High snap, give to Norman. Second effort gets the first down. This is what the schedule has looked like for the Commodores.
Yeah, and as many injuries as they've had, and one of the struggles Vanderbilt has year in and year out anyway in the SEC, even with byes, is depth issues and trying to keep guys healthy. This year you compound some of those injuries and depth issues with no byes, and ultimately 0-7 in the SEC. That effort once again on third down by the little guy, Warren Norman, breaking the tackle of Herman Lathers, moving the chains, critical to begin the second half.
Shotgun snap from the senior center, Bradley Veerland. Pitch and kill, not a pitch and catch, pitch and drop. Udom Uma had a 10-yard gain, but he dropped it.
You can see the body language. Great shots there at both Mackenzie Adams, Bobby Johnson. That's been the theme this season. Now, the passing game not been where it needs to be. Dead last in the SEC, near the bottom in all of college football. Just lack of execution, whether it's accuracy at times. That time a perfectly thrown ball on time by Mackenzie Adams. And Udom Uma does not look it in and secure the catch.
Change on the offensive line for Vanderbilt. Kyle Fisher in at left guard, replacing Ryan Custer. Fisher wears number 72. Option run, Mackenzie Adams picks up 4, maybe 5. Rico McCoy leads the team in tackles with the stop.
That's just a great shot of a quarterback frustrated, knowing on first down after a nice third down conversion. The play is open, there's the ranks, dead last in every category. And you can't just blame it on one phase of the passing game. At times it's been protection. At times it was Larry Smith's accuracy. At times it's precision in the routes and catching and securing the ball. Been all phases of the passing game that's been a struggle this season.
Third down play. Pressure. Norman has it. Well short of the first down marker. Redshirt freshman Herman Lathers came in and made the stop along with Rico McCoy.
Vanderbilt will rotate some of their offense alignment through. That time, the redshirt freshman Caleb Welkins, 78, in a one-on-one situation with the linebacker. Monty Kiffin's guys win. He doesn't dial up too many blitzes. You'll see him on third down as you did there. Now you're going to get the ball back to a red-hot offense.
End-over-end punt by Upson. Fielded on 2 hops. And tackle made at the 30-yard line. Dennis Rogan, a return of 2 yards on a 46-yard punt. Going to keep it here, 11:32 remaining third quarter. First offensive possession for the Tennessee Volunteers. This is what's on the line. Vanderbilt needing a win to get their first SEC win. They're 0-7 so far. While Tennessee, they have a chance to clinch a bowl berth. Didn't go to a bowl last year, would love to go this year. They either need to win tonight They still have a game next week against Kentucky in Lexington, where they could become bowl eligible with their sixth win. Volunteers currently 5 up and 5 down overall, 2-4 in the SEC East. Crompton wants to throw, complete to Jones. Jones makes the first man miss and picks up 8 yards. Jones, the junior from Oklahoma City.
A lot of diversity in the scheme tonight by Lane Kiffin. You've seen two back running downhill. You've seen empty package there. You've seen two tight ends getting down the middle of the field. Lots of personnel groupings, lots of formations. That's a staple of this system that Lane runs.
Hardesty, first carry of the second half. He picks up 8 yards. ESPNU's coverage of college football continues on ESPNU later tonight. Chris Ault's Nevada Wolfpack, led by Colin Kaepernick, they take on the Aggies of New Mexico State. College football primetime, presented by Citi on ESPNU and ESPNU HD tonight at 10:30 Eastern Time. Games being played in Las Cruces, New Mexico. Close to where Billy the Kid was not only captured, but tried. And convicted. And actually hung. Billy the Kid trivia for 100. On first down, Crompton throws to nobody in particular. It's incomplete, trying to get to the fullback, Kevin Cooper.
And you can see Crompton expecting his receiver to come out of his break. Actually, that's the youngster, Bryce Brown, the true freshman. I talk about all that, those multiple looks, and what that does is put a lot of pressure on a defense, even a very bright defense like Vanderbilt. When you go three wides and you go two tights and you go empty, you try to set the tempo and dictate to that defense, and makes that defensive coordinator's job much, much more difficult.
Crompton looking for the tight end, incomplete. Stocker had it go off the fingertips, and it was almost intercepted by Jamie Graham.
There's another shot of your tight end. You saw him down the middle of the field earlier, this time on a wheel route. Good protection. Montario Hardesty steps up. Luke Stocker does his best to go up and get this ball.
Look like his right arm is being held
by Joel Caldwell. That's a veteran move. You're absolutely right, it was held. No call. Fortunately for Tennessee, that ball not intercepted.
Third and 10, Crompton with time. Check down underneath. This one is picked off by Graham. Jamie Graham on the run out. Out of bounds at the 45-yard line. First turnover of the ball game forced by Vandy. And that breaks a long streak of consecutive passes without an interception for Jonathan Crompton.
And you see the frustration by Lane Kiffin. He knows, as well as his offense is playing, he's got a lot of youth and inexperience on defense, and the last thing he wants to do is give any life to Vanderbilt. When turnovers will do that, that will change momentum, that will change field position. Jamie Graham, he's filling in for the injured Myron Lewis. That time the carom goes the way of Vanderbilt.
Vanderbilt plus 4 on the year turnover margin. That's the first interception of Jonathan Crompton in his last 143 passes. John Cole with the catch. That's a long way, 143 passes without an interception for Crompton.
And based on my notes, that is exactly the record that Casey Clawson had at Tennessee. He needed one more pass to break Clawson's all-time record of passes without an interception. Funny how that works out at times. Go 144 passes without an interception, you need one more to break the record. Unfortunately, that carom went the other way.
They're going to measure a little bit short. Second down and a half yard. Bobby Johnson was very aggressive in his decision-making with his offense in the first half. This is a situation where you can be aggressive with a play call. Second down and a half yard. Really, the whole playbook is available.
Yeah, that's interesting. I was chatting with some of the Vanderbilt officials there at halftime, asked him about that call, and they said very uncharacteristic of Bobby Johnson, but maybe epitomizes a season in which you're 0-7 and you want to take that shot. What do you have to lose? As you said, you're not going to a bowl game. The next time these kids will line up and play will be spring practice months from now. He rolled the dice, and Compton and Tennessee made him pay before half. But this is a critical, crucial opportunity now to take advantage of the turnover.
Hand off, Norman. Norman skips over a couple of would-be tacklers and gets to the 30.
You know, these microphones and this technology we have in this day and age is so good. You could hear Mackenzie Adams there changing the play, looking at the alignment, saying 26, 26, 26. Obvious to me, even up here in the booth, based on football terminology, that's going to be the back going to the sixth hole. Better be careful that Tennessee doesn't pick up on some of that language.
Adams keeps it. Brought down from behind, Greg King. True freshman tackles him after a gain of 3. King is getting a lot of playing time in place of LaMarcus Thompson, out with that stinger suffered a week ago in Oxford, Mississippi.
Greg's doing a nice job tonight. We've called his name a number of times. He's been very secure in his tackles. So here you see Vanderbilt, what they're doing. Ted Kane is up here in the booth looking at the defensive alignment of Tennessee. Vanderbilt will come up and line up in their formation, and based on Monty Kiffin's look, change to the best play against that formation.
Adams gets it to the tight end, Barden. Holds on to that one, a pickup of 6.
Really tonight it's been a very vanilla look for Tennessee. As many guys as they have banged up, 2 middle linebackers done for the year. You're on your 3rd middle linebacker without, as he said, LaMarcus Thompson. You're starting a true freshman at strong side backer. You've moved your secondary all over the place, taking corners, moving in the safeties. Not a surprise to see a more vanilla attack defensively.
3rd and a half yard. Pitch out to Norman in space. Gets the first down. Down to the 13-yard line. Anthony Anderson missed the tackle, and that allowed Norman to pick up the 7 yard.
There's certain times that stats can be misleading, and sometimes kickoff return yards, not the greatest stat in the world. It means you're getting a lot of opportunities. I'll tell you, though, Warren Norman is more than a kickoff returner. He is very capable of breaking tackles, his pad level, everything you like to see in a young running back.
They give it to him again. A lot of times this part of the season, those freshmen, those legs become like putty. Not Mr. Norman, still running with some zip.
There's a good shot at Ted Kane. He has got to be excited about the prospects over the next 3 years. He's the guy in the white cap, looking at the defensive alignment. And Warren Norman, exactly to your point, to get through this SEC season, and Zach Stacy's been beat up, lots of backs get beat up. He's been very durable this year.
Another time-consuming drive for the Commodore. Uncharacteristic. First man through, Norman is stoned. He's going to bring a 3rd down. Big fella from Memphis, Dan Williams, with the stick.
Norman needed 88 yards tonight, so he's 30 away. He got Herschel Walker's record, 30 yards away from the freshman single season record of Quani Doster at Vanderbilt as well. Just an opportunity tonight to shatter a bunch of records.
Man down is the senior Dan Williams, who made that last stop. As good as Eric Berry has been through his career, and as many tackles as Rico McCoy has had, Dan Williams, when you talk to the coaching staff, he is the key to the defense in the turnaround over the last couple of weeks. We'll take a timeout. You're watching the SEC on ESPN. Big fella, senior defensive tackle Dan Williams, going off the field in his own power. Good to see. Guy who's got a chance to play professional football, highly thought of.
I like those coaches yesterday saying, and these coaches know they come from the pro ranks, that Dan has made himself some money with his production this season.
Third down and 7. Adams tries to squeeze it in a little bit too strong. John Cole can't come down with it. Field goal unit will have to come on.
Boy, McKenzie is not shy of showing how he feels and showing his emotion, and he's having a lot of fun playing the game, and you can see he's kind of talking to himself and also looking at his receiver, asking John Cole to have a sense of urgency. You get down in that red zone, everything speeds up. You got to have a sense of urgency to your route, knowing that ball is going to be flying in fast.
Ryan Fowler made a field goal back in the first half. This time, gets it to go from 27 yards. Fowler's now made 10 of his last 11 field goal attempts. So, Vandy scores for the first time here in the second half. They trail by 11. You're watching the SEC on ESPN. Welcome back, everyone. Final home game of the season for Tennessee. We're at Neyland Stadium. Tennessee has won 427 games here over the years. That's the second most amount of wins of any Division I-A program here at a particular venue. The only venue that has hosted more home wins has been Georgia Tech's Bobby Dodd Stadium, one in Atlanta. On the return from the 2-yard line, David Oku fumbles it, picks it up, gets out across the 20, out to the 30, make it to 31. Return of 28 yards for the freshman from Oklahoma. Let's take a look at the SEC standings brought to you by Dr. Pepper. Florida Gators, they flexed some muscle today. Non-conference game moved to 11-0. It is a done deal that Florida will take on Alabama in the SEC championship game.
And Ole Miss, the big win today, getting hot, 8-3. Everyone remembers those losses. They're forgetting a little bit about how well Ole Miss is playing down the stretch.
Ole Miss a winner a week ago against Tennessee, winning today against LSU, almost picked off. That would have been back-to-back interceptions of Jonathan Crompton. He went 143 passes without a pick, threw one on a tipped ball to Jamie Graham, and almost had one right there picked off by Casey Hayward.
And he was just a little bit late on that throw, and there are times you have an interception, as he did in the series before, where you may hesitate just a little bit, make sure that receiver's open. It was really the first throw tonight that I saw him not play with anticipation, and Casey Hayward nearly made him pay.
Give to Hardesty, senior tailback. Running hard to the 40-yard line, Sean Richardson tackles him a yard short of the first down marker. ESPN News coverage of college basketball and the O'Reilly Auto Parts Puerto Rico tip-off continues tomorrow, 10:30 a.m. Eastern Time, George Mason and Indiana, 12:30 Eastern, Georgia Tech and Boston University, and at 5:30 Eastern, the 18th-ranked Dayton Flyers take on the Wildcats of Kansas State in the third-place game. The O'Reilly Auto Parts Puerto Rico tip-off on ESPNU tomorrow. Third and one. Hardesty behind the fullback, Kevin Cooper. This is actually Bryce Brown who's got the football. And Brown has the first down. Chris Marv makes the tackle, but the chains will move. Now, what's Lane Kiffin going to be working on with Bryce Brown as the season draws to a close and going into next year?
Bryce Brown has not been healthy this season. He's battled some of those bumps and bruises that you're going to get in the SEC. Not been 100%. They want to continue to develop him physically. Already very mature. You can look at the body there. He does not look like a 18-year-old freshman, but they'll continue to build that speed and quickness in the offseason. Expect to see him even more dynamic a year from now.
They get it to him out in space. Full head of steam for Brown, and he rips across the 50-yard line. Tackled after another first down gain by John Stokes.
And I like what Jim Chaney said yesterday, the offensive coordinator. He said, you know, you teach these kids to come out of high school, the running back position is not just about getting out there and running around people and through people. It's about playing with pad level. And the SEC, it's so physical. And to teach them how to pass block and to teach them on how to get that pad level down and to run through tackles, that's the other area of emphasis for Bryce Brown where he has improved. There's a good shot at Jim Chaney. Lane Kiffin loves to have that brain trust up in the booth as well.
They give it to Brown again. Bryce Brown, the eighth ranked prospect on the ESPN U150 coming out of his senior year in high school in Wichita, Kansas. Do you see him being an elite top shelf runner in the SEC?
I think he really has a chance, Eric. When you can come into this league as a true freshman and he's going to get over 500 yards or has a chance to this season. Yeah, I do. I see that body that's 6'1" and 215 pounds and some of the feet. I'd like to see him 100%. You can see the conversations about being physical and squaring those shoulders. He's had a nice year to learn from Montario Hardesty as well. Montario up over 1,000 yards now on the season. And just the physical maturity.
Man down on the field for Vanderbilt is Sean Richardson, already playing with a torn tendon in his thumb. Now it looks like part of his lower body is being looked at. Looks like the left ankle. Big loss this year for Vanderbilt early in the season was at the safety spot. Ryan Hamilton, one of the better defensive backs in all of the SEC, he ripped a pectoral muscle in the game in Baton Rouge against LSU. We saw that game. And Ryan Hamilton, with gravel in his guts and spit in his eye, he actually played the rest of the game with a pectoral muscle that was ripped away.
Yeah, tough kids. There's no doubt about it that Bobby, in this program, you're going to be very, very physical and tough. And Ryan actually pursuing a six-year, a medical redshirt for this last season, that would be hugely advantageous for Vanderbilt next season.
Al Owens comes into the game replacing Richardson in the backfield. Second down and six. Hardesty. Stopped a little bit short of the first down marker. Chris Marr, first man to meet him. And a flag comes in late.
Maybe some extracurricular activities around the pile. Like Chris Scott, the big left tackle. Have come in around the pile. You saw Eric Berry do that on the other side earlier.
After the play was over, personal foul on the offense, number 79. 15-yard penalty from end of the run. The down counts. It'll be third down.
It is indeed on Chris Scott, and where that really hurts is they were just a yard short of the first down marker. If they'd gotten the first down, it'd be first down and they'd have to move back. But now it's going to be third down. And a whole bunch. It's going to be about third and 16.
Yeah, and that's going to be real frustrating for Lane Kiffin to watch that one on film. That's an obvious from Chris. Your redshirt senior playing some terrific football. You just can't afford to put your offense into this third and very long predicament.
Prompt in with time. Has a man wide open, and it's dropped. Gerald Jones had a touchdown, and he drops the football. If it's possible, it looks like he got handcuffed on that throw.
And Vanderbilt, you saw Richardson out of the game and confusion in their secondary. Brent Trice, the linebacker, moved back to safety, and you can't throw it any better than that. You really can't. There are times receivers will tell you, sometimes the hardest catch is that perfectly thrown football. Too much time to stare at that thing and think about the touchdown to come. Unable to secure the perfect throw from Crompton.
Again, Zach Stacy fielding it inside his 10. And Zach Stacy gets out across the 25 to the 26. A flag comes in. Zach Stacy is going to make Bobby Johnson's hair even whiter than it is. He's making a living out of catching those punts close to his own goal line. It was a 48-yard punt returned out to the 26, but probably a penalty against the Commodores.
During the return, holding on the receiving team, number 29. The penalty is 10 yards in spot of the foul. First down.
So the Commodores will back up. They'll start with the ball on the 15-yard line. When we come back, Eric Berry, arguably the finest defensive back to ever play at Tennessee. Maybe his final football game here at Neyland Stadium. Eric Berry and the Tennessee Volunteers on defense. 24-13 is our score. Vols on top of the Commodores. Eric Berry quite possibly playing his final game here at Neyland Stadium. Didn't actually run through the tee, was actually given that option. Usually only a senior deal. He is a junior, but last year as a sophomore, winning the SEC Defensive Player of the Year Award. He's got 14 career picks. He is a semifinalist for the Jim Thorpe Award, given the best defensive back in the country, the Chuck Bednarik Award. Semifinalist, Defensive Player of the Year. He will find out whether or not he wins those awards for the Home Depot ESPNU College Football Awards Thursday, December 10th, 7 p.m. Eastern Time on ESPN. And in case you're curious as to what Eric Berry is wearing when he goes to the College Football Awards, you can watch the red carpet show on ESPNU an hour before the actual College Football Awards start. That's at 6 p.m. Eastern Time. Red carpet show. Love it. Other awards given out, the Blitnikoff Award, Best Receiver. Lou Groza, Best Place Kicker. Ray Guy Award. You can find out who's the best punter. That's on December 10th, Thursday. Second down and nine. True freshman Zach Stacy in the backfield next to Mackenzie Adams. Adams rolls out to his right, completes it to Cole. And Cole's got running room down the right sideline out to the 35. Pickup of 19 yards. These are the awards that'll be passed around. Davey O'Brien Award, Doak Walker, best back. Outland Trophy, best interior lineman.
You know, it's been a lot of conversation around town and pro scouts and otherwise. I was even asking the Vanderbilt coaches today about Eric Berry, and his numbers are down. Last year, 7 interceptions. He's very, very close, 8 yards away from breaking Terrell Buckley's all-time return yardage record for interceptions. And this year, Monty Kiffin's asked him to be a little different player, not be that center fielder, to come up around the box. And talking to Monty yesterday and asking him about Berry's prospects at the next level, and Monty said, listen, I'm not a promoter. I'm not here to tell you, you know, anything but my honest opinion. And he said Berry is so unique because of his versatility and why at the next level he's going to be very, very special, because as he's proven this year, he can come down around the line of scrimmage and make 70 tackles, and he's proven his career he can also pick off that ball in center field.
So Eric Berry will be down in Orlando December 10th, Thursday, for the Home Depot ESPNU College Football Award Show. 7 p.m. Eastern Time on ESPN. An hour before that, the Red Carpet Show. 6 p.m. Eastern Time, ESPNU. A lot of awards handed out. And Eric Berry's got a more than a puncher's chance of taking home some hardware.
You know, you think about the NFL game and who Monty Kiffin had at Tampa Bay. And he had John Lynch, and he was that guy that came around the box and was very physical. And there you see Gray King. Well, he's only about the 8th linebacker playing for Tennessee. That's an exaggeration, but not by much. And he's very gingerly holding that arm and shoulder coming off the field. He's filling in for LaMarcus Thompson. And already this season, they've lost 2 of their middle linebackers to torn ACLs, Nick Reves and Savion Fraser, both ACL injuries. A linebacker position that Rico McCoy a week ago playing injured, tonight playing nowhere near 100%, but having to play because all that's left really on the roster now. There's a good shot of the captain, Nick Reves, is his brother. In fact, Shane Reves, number 30, you can expect to probably see him come into this game as well. Shane, the walk-on younger brother, both sons of the famous kicker from the University of Tennessee, Juan Reves.
Yeah, Shane Reves has come into the game. He wears number 30. He's on the end of the line of scrimmage, faking a blitz. Now he's stepping back. There he is, clapping his hands. Sophomore walk-on from the Knoxville suburb of Farragut. First down at 10. Adams, pocket collapses, and he goes down. Sacked. Dan Williams back in the game. Sacks him for a loss of 8. Let's go back to the studio. Lowell, what's going on?
Well, Stanford opened up a 14-zip lead over the California Golden Bears, but Cal has now scored 17 straight. That's Shane Vereen from the Wildcats to give Cal the lead. Oregon also opened up a 14-0 lead over Arizona, but that's Jerron Kreiner with a touchdown, 14-7. Ducks still with the lead. Eric?
Thank you, my man. 1:30 remaining, third quarter. Vanderbilt down by 11, second and a ton. Give to Zach Stacy, and almost squeezes out of that tackle. Makes it out across the 35 to the 36, a pickup of 10.
Dan Williams made the nice play on the sack. This front four going to be asked to do even more. Dan, Ben Martin, Chris Walker, Wes Brown, so many backups behind them in linebacker. Critical that they make some big plays up front.
Out of his break, and a flag is down late in the backfield. It looks like it's going to be a hold. That's the preliminary signal.
Holding
on Vanderbilt
on the offense, number 62. Penalties declined, fourth down.
And Ryan Seymour,
excuse me, Eric, one thing you know about Monty Kiffin, at any level he played and preparing against him in the NFL, he would bring a different third down blitz. That was his MO at the NFL level. Every week he's going to bring a nickel blitz on third down, something you haven't seen. And really the only pressure tonight have been two third downs, and both have been effective for the Volunteers.
No one has punted more in FBS football so far this year than Brett Upson. That punt is going to be down at the 15-yard line. That's where Tennessee will take over. With 16 seconds remaining in the third quarter, we've still got a good one here in Knoxville. 24-13 is our score. You're watching the SEC on ESPN. ESPNU College Football Primetime presented by Citi. Tennessee on top of Vanderbilt, 24-13. They've got the football. 16 seconds remaining, third quarter. Final home game of the year. Senior night here at Neyland Stadium.
I'm going to expect to see, with all these injuries defensively, even more run from Tennessee in this fourth quarter.
They run it on first down. Hardesty picks up a yard. More than likely the final play of the third quarter. And it is. We've got 45 minutes in the books. Over 100,000 strong here at Neyland Stadium. In an 11-point game, Tennessee on top of Vanderbilt. You're watching the SEC on ESPN. Tennessee on top of Vanderbilt, 24-13. Just 3 points scored in that third quarter. Vanderbilt getting the field goal from Ryan Fowler. Second down and 9. Tennessee with the football. Ball in the 21-yard line. Complete. Denarius Moore scored a touchdown in that first half as his first grab of the second half.
I'll be curious to see what Bruce Fowler does here in the fourth quarter. You would expect, with all the injuries to Tennessee defensively, that Tennessee would want to run the ball. That last play, a second and 10 situation, Bruce brought a run blitz. Both linebackers, Crompton beat the blitz, getting the ball out of his hand. But Bruce, one of the more nifty play callers, very respected in this SEC.
Third down and 1. Deep back is Montario Hardesty, already over 100 yards. He's got the ball and the first down. Pickup of 5. Hardesty now with 114 yards. He's really been featured tonight, Brock. Each of the last two games, well, combined over the last two games, just 115. He's almost got that tonight. in three quarters of play.
Yeah, and he's pushing towards 1,100 yards on a very productive season. Another thing to keep in mind, Vanderbilt defensively and offensively, the fourth quarter not been kind to them this year.
Hardesty again. Out to the 50. Down to the 42. Tackled by Eddie Foster, but not before a gain of 24 yards.
No surprise here. You go to your best players right now. You left tackle Chris Scott on this offensive line. And Montario Hardesty running like a senior playing his last game in this stadium, now close to 140 yards. As I was saying, the fourth quarter this year, Vanderbilt outscored 79-43. Often the case of being worn down, and Tennessee doing their part here to take advantage.
Tight ends on both sides of the formation. Hardesty brought down at the 40. Joel Caldwell jumped on his back.
A nice option for Lane Kiffin. Jim Cheney, the offensive coordinator, they feel like they have four backs. We actually saw a torn pool earlier. You see David Oku on kickoffs. Bryce Brown, obviously the phenom freshman. A stable of running backs, the deepest position on this team for Tennessee.
Brown is in the game, replacing Hardesty. And they give it to Brown. Sheds the first tackler, but can't make the second man miss. Gain of two. It'll bring up third down.
Nice combination of speed and power out of Hardesty. Now, unlike his counterpart, Jonathan Crompton, fifth-year seniors who paid their dues, gone through ups and downs and injuries in their career, and Hardesty taking full advantage of his chances in 2009 and making his senior night one to remember.
Hardesty on the sideline with Bryce Brown in the game on this third down at six. Now they put Brown in motion. Crompton has time over the middle. Caught short of the first down by Quentin Hancock. Gain of three. Hancock's third catch of the ball game. Wouldn't be surprised if Tennessee goes for it here. Kind of in Lane Kiffin's M.O. They're going to send in reinforcements, and they are going to go for it. Lane has been very aggressive on fourth down all season long. He's going to go for it on fourth down and four from the 36.
We saw this about the same area of the field backfire for Vanderbilt to end the first half.
On a throw for it. Tight end Stocker can't hold on. Wouldn't have gotten the first down anyway. He had a man bearing down on him. Casey Hayward would have made the open field tackle. So the gamble by Lane Kiffin doesn't pay off. Ball goes over on downs to Vanderbilt. They've still got plenty of time, down by 11. Welcome back, everyone. Fourth quarter, 11:27 remaining. Tennessee on top of Vanderbilt by a score of 24-13. Brock Hewitt, I'm Eric Collins. Andy's got the football. They're the only team that has scored here in the second half. A field goal by Ryan Fowler. Kenzie Adams, fifth-year senior from Tulsa, takes the shotgun snap. Over the middle, complete short gain to Udom Uma. Gain of four. Quickly, let's go to the studio in Lowell Galindo.
Yeah, this one all about California running back Shane Vereen, one of the top backups last season. Now with Javid Best down, he's the main man. Three-yard touchdown run, 24 unanswered for Cal. They're up 24-14, Eric.
That Stanford team is Jekyll and Hyde. Thank you, Lowell. Second down and six. Kenzie Adams replacing Larry Smith out with that hamstring 3 games ago. Hands it off to Warren Norman, who struggles forward for two. Right now, Vanderbilt at their high watermark for SEC scoring. Last week against Kentucky, they scored 13 points in a losing effort. They've never scored more than 14 in a conference game this year. Check that, more than 13 in a conference game this year.
Third down, the last two occasions have been blitzed by Monty Kiffin. Even with walk-ons in and youngsters in, he's been very aggressive. This is a big third and four. Let's see what Monty dials up defensively.
Ten men close to the line of scrimmage. Pass is high and incomplete. Turner Wimberly thought that he was held.
And I like the call there by Monty Kiffin. He's going to put the burden on Vanderbilt and their wide receivers, who, Eric, you talk about the lack of production and points, just 13, the high water mark. A lot of that is attributed to the inability to win in one-on-one situations. It's highlighted down in the red zone, but right there, a critical third down. Monty Kiffin trusting his secondary players to win the one-on-one battle, and they do again.
Upson doing a lot of that lately. Punts it inside the five, and it bounces into the end zone. It'll be a touchback ball to the 20-yard line for Tennessee. There is a flag down close to the line of scrimmage.
Personal foul. Illegal contact on the snapper by the defense.
Wow.
15-yard penalty for free spot. Automatic first down.
Wow. What a break for Vanderbilt. Well, Lane Kiffin wants a name and a number. All right, now he wants a name and a number. Who did that? Because Vanderbilt's going to stay on the field offensively.
Boy, Lane Kiffin, you can tell, very, very expressive, frustrated by that. Wants an explanation. Contact on the long snapper is the call. These referees try to protect those long snappers. Boy, what a critical call. Let's see if Vanderbilt can take advantage.
Incomplete, trying to get it to Colin Ashley.
There is a shot. I absolutely do not see that. That looked to me like the long snapper not only snapped the ball, was able to stand up into athletic position and defend himself before contact. I don't understand that call. Now Tennessee's defense must rise up and respond.
Blitz is on. Uma drops it again. Mackenzie Adams getting a little frustrated with his receiving corps.
Take a look again. It's obvious the snapper here. You tell me, I don't see that call. And I understand protecting those guys if they get a blow delivered to them before they can get their head up and respond. I don't see that there. And what I do see is yet another drop in this passing game.
I'll tell you right now, Mackenzie Adams has now discovered what Larry Smith was dealing with all season long. Larry Smith was not particularly accurate, but on the times that he was, his receivers weren't bailing him out. A lot of drops for Vanderbilt this year for both quarterbacks. Third down and 10. Commodores just handed a gift. Trying to cash in.
Not a blitz look here. Let's see if Tennessee will walk and try to disguise if indeed they do blitz or if they end up playing zone in third and extra long.
Collapses, arm hit, incomplete. Wes Brown and Ben Martin met Mackenzie Adams in the backfield.
And this front four, Dan Williams had a sack earlier in this third quarter, and this front four is getting home, and that is exactly what Ed Orgeron, you see him commend his defensive lineman. Wes Brown, excellent push, gets on the edge of that offensive guard. Affects that pocket. This defense at its best, any defense, when you can rush four, play seven in zone, make those windows very difficult for the quarterback to find.
This time, a beautiful punt. It's going to be down at the 9-yard line. A punt of 33, no return. That's where Tennessee will take over when we come back. Busy day in the SEC. We'll tell you all about Southeastern Conference and what happened on a Saturday afternoon and evening. That's coming up when we come back. You're not going to miss. Not going to want to miss what happened between LSU and Ole Miss. Just a heartbreaker in Oxford for the Tigers. Welcome back, everyone. Neyland Stadium, Knoxville, Tennessee. These two schools separated by about 180 miles of I-40. Tennessee with the lead and the football. Crompton hands it off. Monterio Hardesty. Gain of three on first down. This is the scoreboard from the SEC today.
And Bobby Petrino and Ryan Mallett continue to put up big numbers. Florida and Alabama, they take care of their out-of-conference foes. Ole Miss hangs on. Fourth and 26. LSU gets it to the inside the 10-yard line. They can't spike the ball in time. And Kentucky and Rich Brooks making it interesting against Georgia, down just a touchdown.
If LSU had had a timeout, they had kicked the chip shot field goal and got out of Oxford with a stunning win. Tough break for the Bayou Bengals. That's the game of the day by far in the SEC.
Up there in Oxford, much like last week, Dexter McCluster, I think Houston Nutt kicking himself a little bit. He wanted to protect his undersized McCluster. Didn't know at his size if he could endure through the entire SEC schedule, but the last four games he's been on fire. Ryan Mallett adds to his touchdowns, now 28 on the year, tied actually with Compton coming into tonight. Tim Tebow obviously lit up Chattanooga, as did Mark Ingram against Chattanooga.
On third down, Crompton completes it. First down to the tight end, Stocker. Stocker's had a big day, a pickup of eight. Let's go back to the studio in Lo Galindo.
Eric, thank you so much. Kentucky's Mr. Do-It-All, Randall Cobb, was questionable coming into this game against Georgia with a bruised shoulder. Good to have him back. He scampers 12 yards for the touchdown. That cuts the gap to seven. Georgia still with the lead in the third.
Thank you, Lowell. Well, Kentucky, they will finish off the regular season at home next week against these Tennessee Volunteers. Early weather report. It's going to be cold and nasty at Commonwealth Stadium. I guess, what do you expect? Late November in Kentucky. Pass is complete. Monterio Hardesty close to the first down marker. No, that's Luke Stocker. Another catch for Stocker. His fifth of the ball game.
Going to get him up to 47 yards. The big touchdown before half. Tell you right now, Tennessee defensively going to have their hands full with Kentucky next week, and all the running and different looks from Hawk and Randall Cobb, and even more injuries to this Tennessee defense.
Hardesty has the football and has the first down. Also next week, Arkansas. We'll finish off the regular season against LSU. You talk about Ryan Mallett, the season he has had. And I wonder, people haven't really been talking about it, I just wonder, Ryan Mallett is going to be draft eligible. I know this is just his sophomore season. He's got two more seasons to play, but he's a big guy with a big arm. You'd imagine the NFL scouts would like him.
Yeah, but third-year sophomores, there's a track record of that. You know, you talk about fourth-year, like Mark Sanchez last year and the heat that he took. Very rarely. Tom Marinovich was a third year. Tommy Maddox was a third year sophomore. More often than not, those NFL scouts want to see at least another year. And I think if I'm Ryan Mallett, just like Jonathan Crompton tonight, you've seen him evolve as this season's moved along. The more comfortable the receivers have gotten, he's gotten with Lane Kiffin's system. Can you imagine Ryan Mallett yet another year with Bobby Petrino and all the weapons they're continuing to assemble?
Don't you think that Sam Bradford of Oklahoma would have liked a do-over and left last year, as opposed to after suffering numerous injuries and then basically having his draft stock go down because of all the injuries and the questions now? Flag looks like it's going to be on the offensive line for Tennessee.
You know, an even better question, that's going to be Chris Scott trying to get off the ball early on that run play. Who's your first team All-SEC quarterback?
Prior to the snap, ball start. Offense, number 79, 5-yard penalty,
It remains second down.
Now, Tim Tebow is obviously the guy leading the number one team in America, but his numbers pale in comparison to the efficiency of Ryan Mallett. 28 touchdowns. That's just three interceptions going into that game tonight as well. Top three in efficiency in the country. All the talk in the preseason about Jevon Snead's one vote for first team preseason All-SEC quarterback. It'll be an interesting conversation postseason-wise. Hard not to give it to Tim Tebow. Shatters even more SEC records and touchdowns and runs, and they win. Ryan Mallett at least has made it into the conversation because of the gaudy numbers he's putting up.
Hardesty pushed out of bounds. It'll bring up a third down and 10. Clock continues to move. 6.5 remaining. Should Lane Kiffin's team hold on, they will be bowl eligible. Play clock down to 6. Crompton, quick slant, ball popped in the air, incomplete. Good stick, ball popped loose. That was Jamie Graham, who seems to always be around the action.
Yeah, he had the interception earlier, and he's seen about 8 times tonight Tennessee running this slant pattern, running very successfully. Denarius Moore, a number of catches on that slant on third down. That time, he read the 3 receivers to the other side, knows in this system, with that zone spacing away, typically you'll see the slant. He jumps it and makes the play, does Jamie Graham.
Zach Stacy back deep, fields the punt at the 29-yard line. Stacy always an adventure on these punt returns. Goes sideways, eventually picks up a yard on the return. 5:54 remaining. When we come back, Vanderbilt will have the football. And we'll talk about the BCS, how things are looking for the top dogs, Texas, Alabama, and Florida. Vanderbilt Commodores down by 11 points against the Tennessee Volunteers, but they do have the football, and they've got a chance. Deal with the pulse. Take a look at the BCS standings so far this weekend, how things have resulted.
I think this loss today by LSU helps Boise State. I think TCU is a lock one of the other at-large games. They're not an automatic qualifying conference, but Boise State helped, in my opinion, today by that LSU loss, because Pittsburgh-Cincinnati are going to play each other later this year, and one of those teams will have a loss, and I believe Boise State will run the table.
Mackenzie Adams wants to throw on first down. Nobody home. Incomplete. Had a chance to watch the large bulk of that game last night, Boise State against Utah State, and I'm telling you, Boise State, they score more touchdowns when no one is around them than any other program in the country.
Yeah, look at that. One of the 6 teams still perfect. Chris Peterson and that scheme is very, very innovative. Chip Kelly gets a lot of credit. He deserves it out at Oregon. But year after year, new pieces, new personnel, and Boise State continues to put up enormous offensive numbers.
Has his tight end Barton, and Barton hangs on to that one. A big gainer down to the 38, 31 yards.
Nice little wrinkle here by Vanderbilt themselves, and that's the big tight end Barton getting a one-on-one matchup with a unhealthy Rico McCoy, doing the best he can to gut through tonight, not at full speed. Barton and Adams take advantage.
Blitz picked up nicely. Catch made by Wimberly. And he is hit with force down at the 30-yard line, a pickup of 7.
Now, he may not be able to run at full speed tonight, but still lowering those pads, delivering a blow, does McCoy there. Very physical football player, but how about Mackenzie Adams right now, bringing a little bit of life into this game?
Rico McCoy, probably only about 80%. I guess you would say he hasn't been the real McCoy tonight. A little bit slow. Steps out of bounds after the catch, does Brandon Barton. Another first down. Take a look at the Dr. Pepper quest for the coach's trophy. Top 2 teams in the BCS, Urban Meyer, Nick Saban, combining for 3 BCS titles, 4 SEC titles. They're going to meet in the SEC championship game in Atlanta. Under 5 minutes to play. Hand off to the freshman, Norman. and Norman breaks the tackle. Down to the 10, pushed out of bounds. That'll be another first down. Kid from Stone Mountain, Georgia, rips off a dozen yards.
I'll tell you, he is impressive in his lower half. You look at some guys and their body types and you think, yeah, they can break tackles. You look at Warren Norman at 185 pounds, and physically he doesn't look like he has the legs to run through those tackles, but he continuously does so.
Red zone has been an issue offensively for Vanderbilt all season long. Pass is incomplete, looking for John Cole. I guess Vanderbilt, obviously they'd love the touchdown, but really all they need to keep their hopes alive is a field goal. That would make this a one possession game. They'd be down by 8.
That is true, but when you're 1 of 3 in the red zone and you score just 13 of 32 times coming into this game, momentum, confidence, it is imperative to get a touchdown here.
Both teams really put the
pressure. Really put the pressure on the Volunteers.
Plenty of time over the middle. They split the difference to Wimberly. They were at the 9, now they're down at the 4.
Exactly to your point, if you don't convert here, you obviously kick the field goal to make it a one possession game, but you just talk about putting the pressure and really getting these 100,000 fans very, very nervous. You put a touchdown on the board, really changes the landscape of this game.
See if they go to the tight end, number 6, Borden. Looking the other way. Cole has a pop in the air. Intercepted. Logan has the football. Is that Rogan or is that Eric Berry? No, it's Rogan. Dennis Rogan has the football. There is a flag down in the end zone.
Pass interference on the defense.
Vanderbilt is still alive. They call the penalty on the sophomore Anthony Anderson.
Wow, that is 2 calls now, pivotal calls in this fourth quarter. Anderson is in tight coverage on this slant route. He looks like he's clearly in front of the receiver, breaking in front often on those slants. It's the contact through the receiver. Those 2 shots look like Anderson got his body around.
Norman stopped short of the goal. Another flag down on the field. That was a tough pass interference call on Anthony Anderson.
I'd like to see the first replay we had. I think that was a better look.
Prior to the snap, full start, offense, number 68, 5-yard penalty. It remains first down.
Riley Lauer called for that penalty.
Yeah, you run those slants, and those are bang-bang plays down in the red zone. They happen so fast. Look at Anthony Anderson on the outside. Is there any contact with the receiver? That referee in the back may have been able to see an arm around the waist as he cuts in front of Cole. But very minimal contact. Give the credit to the referee in the very back. You see Bobby Johnson imploring his guys to get up and get on that line and get going. That ref had a better look from behind. There could have been a chance Anderson grabbed as he went around Cole, but not much contact on those 2 replays.
To the end zone. Incomplete. Looking for Barton.
This has to be a house of horrors right now if you're a Vanderbilt fan and you've watched this all season long. Another precise throw, thrown exactly where Mackenzie Adams needs to make that throw, away from the defender, away from the linebacker. Barton does everything right, shields Herman Lathers, but is unable again to finish and drops the football.
Second down. Here comes the blitz to Norman. Wow! Stephon Reigns and others just laying the wood. Intentional grounding.
Intentional grounding on the offense, number 9. The penalty will place the ball. It's a foul and includes a loss of down. Fourth down.
When you get down into the red zone, you must seize your opportunities. That field condenses. There's not many chances that you're going to have wide open receivers. That time, Tennessee once again drops 7 in the zone. Wes Brown forces the issue. That drop critical on second down.
This field goal attempt critical. And it's good from 32 yards out. Fowler continues his excellent season. He has made 3 field goals this evening. We've got a 1-possession game. Vanderbilt needs to hold Tennessee, get the ball back, and punch it in again. Don't go anywhere. You're watching the SEC on ESPN. ESPNU College Football Primetime presented by Citi. 8-point lead for Tennessee. They're going to have the football after Vanderbilt kicks off. 2:54 remaining in this game. Offense going along really well in the first half. For Tennessee, Montario Hardesty, a touchdown run. Mackenzie Adams and Vanderbilt, they would answer. Touchdown there to Ryan Van Rensburg. But then the Vols caught fire. Crompton to Denarius Moore. And then another touchdown right before the half. Great catch by Luke Stocker back to the end zone. But in the second half, it's been a different story. The only points scored have come off that right toe of Ryan Fowler. A couple of field goals. And the lead is now just 8. Warren Norman, 219 all-purpose yards. He's earned the scholarship. Jonathan Crompton, very good first half. Second half, not so much. And what do? You kick it away? Or do you go for the onside kick? Or do you call timeout? Timeout is called by Tennessee. Brock, what do you think? What's the play call here? You kick it deep or do you go for the onside kick?
The way your defense has played in this second half, I think you've hit and your offense is struggling and has struggled all season long. I think you've got to try to kick this deep and use your timeouts and count on some form of field position. You kick the onside kick and you don't get it. I don't think you have a chance offensively to drive the ball the length of the field to get that touchdown and 2-point conversion.
Bobby Johnson's team down by a touchdown and a 2-point conversion. ESPNU's coverage of college football continues later tonight on ESPNU. Nevada, great offense for the Wolfpack, taking on the Aggies of New Mexico State. College football primetime presented by Citi on ESPNU and ESPNU HD tonight at 10:30 Eastern time.
But when you are 0-7 in the conference, just like at the end of that first half, Bobby Johnson was aggressive. Going for it on fourth down, ultimately not getting it, and Tennessee drove down a minute to go and scored before half. Looks like he's going to go for the onside kick.
High kick, and it is going to be Tennessee football. Bryce Brown, true freshman, on the hands team, makes the catch.
And Ryan Fowler, 3 field goals tonight. Can't execute that kick much better. Lots of hang time. And you saw Casey Hayward there. He's running down trying to knock off the defenders. A little bit of frustration from Bobby Johnson and staff. They knew that was a good kick, as good a chance as you can get. But how about the headiness of your true freshman, Bryce Brown, high pointing that ball and making the play.
So now Vanderbilt needs a stop. Tennessee may already be in 4-down territory. Hardesty playing his final home game. Gets 4 yards on first down. Timeout is called by Vanderbilt.
Now, I will say this, to Bobby Johnson's credit, Tennessee has a lot of problems in their kicking game. They're using a kicker that was on a JV team last year and just joined the team a few weeks ago and has struggled all season to kick field goals. And his defense in the second half has played good against the run. They've been stout. He's expecting them to hold the fort here. It's just that Vanderbilt will have to go the long field when they get it back.
Brock, question for you. I know you weren't a special teams demon, but you saw a shot of Ryan Fowler, the kicker for Vanderbilt on the sideline. There he is with the headset on. He was just doing what he's instructed to do. But why do you always see an onside kick to one side of the field where you limit yourself when you're trying to get the loose ball if it does come loose and you're limited by the sideline? How come it's never tried in the middle of the field?
That's a good question. I think you're trying to get your defenders down there in that small area of the field and allow them to put some hits and disrupt those guys receiving it, you know, and shorten that window, I guess. That's a tough question, Collins. You know, typically you see those kicks to the middle, only squib kick situations where your odds are much, much less.
Patient run by Hardesty. He gets out to the 35-yard line. Now, this is what is on the line. Vanderbilt, they have not won a conference game this season. This is their final game of the year. They're not bowl eligible. Bobby Johnson just trying to get one win on the left side of the win-loss column on the year in SEC play. While Lane Kiffin in Tennessee, they're trying to become bowl eligible. They need that sixth win. If they don't get it tonight, they're going to have another chance next Saturday evening when they take on Kentucky in Lexington. Should they become bowl eligible? These are the SEC bowl tie-ins.
In a number of those representatives here in Knoxville tonight. Loss by LSU opens the door to the Georgias and the Tennessees. If they can finish strong, and that Arkansas game, and as red hot as they are offensively, that's not a gimme for LSU. Everyone knows 1-2 in this conference. Everyone thought it would be LSU, clearly number three, but Mississippi making a statement down the stretch. Can Georgia and Tennessee get red, red hot? They're competitive for that third spot within the conference.
Vandy needs a stop. Hardesty has the first down. Now, more than likely, Tennessee can just run out the clock. Let's go to the studio in Lo Galindo.
Well, Larry, coming up next, we're going to check out Vaitaua and the Nevada Wolfpack, one of the top ground games in the nation. They're getting set for the Aggies of New Mexico State. That game coming up 10:30 Eastern time. Eric?
Thank you, Lowell. And Nevada, they will run that football on you, just like Montario Hardesty has done against Vanderbilt on this drive. Three straight carries, gets the first down, clock continuing to move. And he has one timeout remaining. See if they choose to use it here. ESPNU's coverage of college basketball. The O'Reilly Auto Parts Puerto Rico tip-off continues tomorrow, 10:30 a.m. Eastern. George Mason against Indiana, 12:30 Eastern. Georgia Tech and Boston University, 5:30 Eastern. Dayton Flyers, ranked 18th in the country, take on the Wildcats of Kansas State. O'Reilly Auto Parts Puerto Rico tip-off tomorrow on ESPNU. Down to the 25.
Now, this has been a very scrappy effort by Vanderbilt defensively. Maybe not as clean for Tennessee.
Why is Vanderbilt not calling a timeout?
Now, they're going to wait and burn it and use it just on that final third down. You got three downs to use it. Yeah, a little surprise. Typically, you see it again earlier in the down situation, but no, not surprised by Vanderbilt's effort defensively. They've held Tennessee scoreless in the second half. You look at their season: Kentucky 24, Florida 27, LSU 23, Mississippi State 15. They played good enough defense to win some of these games, just not executing in the passing game.
Third and five. Hardesty is stopped, and now Vanderbilt uses their final timeout. that kind of flies in the face of math. It just doesn't make any sense to just let all that clock burn away. That's what they choose to do.
And had they used it earlier, there are going to be two more plays, Eric, that more than likely would have run the same amount of time off the clock, just when they choose to use it.
Tennessee with one regular season game remaining next week, Commodore Stadium in Lexington, taking on Rich Brooks's Kentucky Wildcats.
That will be a tough matchup to talk about when you look at all of the injury situations now that Lane is facing. It was Band-Aid coming into this game. Rico McCoy not 100%. Third string redshirt freshman middle linebacker Herman Lathers making his third start. LaMarcus Thompson, strong side linebacker, out with a stinger. Greg King goes out of this game with an injury. What looked like his neck, arm, shoulder area. You're down to walk-on players coming in. And next week, Lane knows he will be in a real dogfight on the road against a Kentucky team. Like a lot of these teams in the SEC that make their living running the football first.
Well, after the rough 2 weeks that Lane Kiffin and his coaching staff and this entire university has had with the off-the-field incidents, with the loss against Ole Miss, a win, no matter what the final score is going to be much welcome here in Rocky Top. Pitch out right side. And Vanderbilt is going to get the football back. Chains of possession, clock stops. Stephen Stone with the tackle. And the Commodores have it with 26 seconds remaining. Now the fact that they didn't get a touchdown last time really hurts. They had to settle for the field goal. Now they can't settle for the field goal. They need the full six and the two-point conversion.
And this is where that conversation about going for the onside kick or not also comes in. You go for that onside kick, you leave yourself, if you don't get it, a very, very long field. Exactly what Vanderbilt is facing now.
Vanderbilt with five offensive touchdowns so far in eight SEC games. They need an offensive touchdown now with 26 seconds remaining. Underneath, good thing that was dropped. That could have ended the game if that had been a catch.
Yeah, if you're Mackenzie Adams now, you must make throws that pass the chains. You have no chance if you throw it underneath. This time will run out and this game will end. The only chance you have is to throw it beyond those 10 yards where the clock will stop with the first down. Anything underneath, I think they'll start playing Rocky Top again.
Adams gets out of bounds. Clock stops, 14 seconds remaining.
Gutty effort from McKenzie tonight. You watch that game film, and he did everything in his power. Very accurate with his throws. A couple chances in the red zone, a slant. John Cole not quite getting his head around. Barton drops the touchdown right on the goal line. Unfortunately, been the story of the Vanderbilt Commodores 2009.
And Adams picked off by Wes Brown. And Brown, his final play as a collegian here at home, scores a touchdown. That's the way you finish off senior night if you're Wes Brown.
And did you see Lane Kiffin? Did you see the joy in Lane Kiffin? Remember Lane Kiffin yesterday in our production meeting talking about all these injuries and guys not practicing. And he said big Wes Brown can hardly practice. He's got two knees that are just aching. He's been beat up his whole career. Really epitomizes the heart and the desire and the determination. And you could see the pure joy in Lane Kiffin as his big fifth-year senior rumbles in carrying the Commodore for the touchdown.
Wes Brown is hot. Had his first career interception a week ago against Ole Miss. Gets another one, and he converts it into a touchdown.
I can't even imagine what's going through his head right now as he's staring at that checkered end zone. And look at Kiffin, so excited. Yeah, he didn't recruit Wes Brown. Yes, Wes is a fifth-year senior, but I love it. I love the emotion. And you you could tell yesterday there was just joy with a lot of these guys. And Rico McCoy, he said just heroic a week ago to gut it out, get through the game. Lane has so much respect for so many of these guys and the toughness they've displayed. Maybe none greater than Wes Brown. He legitimately said he could not practice all week long. He's got two knees that are old, that are beat up, that are aching as this season has endured. And as you said, to cap his senior moment in the last game he'll ever play here in Knoxville, that's pretty special stuff. I told you they'd play Rocky Top again. '77, '78, the last time Tennessee did not go to consecutive bowls. They'll be bowling this season. Win number six. They'll be looking for seven up in Lexington next Saturday.
Squib kick. Of the season for Vanderbilt, it is. Tennessee, they're bowl eligible for the first time since 2007. Rookie head coach Lane Kiffin is going to take his Vols to a bowl game, still with one regular season game remaining. Congratulations to senior Jonathan Crompton and the rest of the senior class. They win out in their final home game here at Neyland Stadium in Knoxville, Tennessee. Coming up next, SportsCenter U coming your way right here on ESPNU. Once again, our final score, one final time, 31-16. Tennessee finishes the season of Vanderbilt. For my partner, Brock Huer, and our entire crew, I'm Eric Collins saying so long, everybody, from Knoxville.